So good morning. Welcome to this morning session. It's a pleasure to introduce Albert Fatih. He will be talking about singularities or solutions of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, a toy model, distance to a closed subset. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, so Alessio, what can I say? We met here in Pisa 14 years ago. So there are probably a lot of people that we have to thank for that. Stefano Marmi was the one who brought me here, so, you know. But in fact, the reason when I know Stefano Marmi so well is because he worked with Jean-Christophe Yocoz. And I met Jean-Christophe at the same age I met you. And knowing Jean-Christophe, after I met you, I realized that you would become a Fields Medal right away. That was clear. So there, you have a lot of points in common. Unfortunately, he passed away, but for the way you were looking at mathematics and also the way you behave in everyday life, you are basically two nice persons. I have never seen Jean-Christophe aggressive, neither you. So this is not so usual among very first-rate mathematicians. Sometimes they are not so nice people, so please, keep on being nice. Okay, so I'm going to talk of singularities of solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation and the distance to a closed subset. I think the distance to a closed subset is one kind of subject that has been developed in Pisa since a long time. So I'm not going to start right away with the general framework of viscosity solution and so on, because this is a large audience. I would rather not give talk which is too technical. And I'm going to talk to you about something that you all know. So I'm going to start with a closed subset in RK, and I'm going to consider the Euclidean distance in RK. Sorry, but I don't know why the commands have been inverted here. And I'm going to take the distance to the closed subset C. So the function, the distance to the closed subset C, where, of course, we have the Euclidean norm. And this is a function which is Lipschitz with constant 1. You all know it. And you probably think that you know everything about this distance. Well, I'm going to tell you a couple of things that you don't know. Okay. Of course, you know that it's differentiable everywhere, and it's usually not differentiable everywhere. In fact, there is a theorem of Motzkin, which says that it's differentiable everywhere away from C, if and only if C is convex. So now I'm going to look at the set of singularity of the distance away from C. Okay, because at C, you know, you can be differentiable if you are in the interior, on the boundary. Sometimes you can be differentiable, sometimes not, but it's not the most interesting part. Okay, so I'm going to give you topological property on the set of singularity. Here is the first one. The set of singularity is locally path connected. In fact, it's even locally contractible, as I'll show you later. Okay, when C is a C2 submanifold, the theorem is known for the closure of the singularity. Okay. This is called the cut locus of C. Note that in a paper by Mantegazza and Menucci, they give an example of a C11 closed curve in the plane for which the set of singularity of the distance is, the closure is not locally connected. So the set of singularity is locally connected, but the closure is not, you know, contrary to the case when C is a C2 submanifold. But already C11, the property breaks down. Okay, and even worse than that, the closure of the singularity has positive Lebesgue measure. Of course, the set of singularity has Lebesgue measure 0 because the function is differentiable almost everywhere. So in fact, this theorem for a closed subset is quite strong. What do you know about the set of singularity, the set of singularity of a Lipschitz function. The only restriction on the singularity set of a Lipschitz function that we know is that it should have measure zero. Okay? So the definitely the general set like that of measure zero is not locally connected. It has no reason to be locally connected. Of course, if you are a little bit more sophisticated, you are going to object to this argument, and here in Pisa, most of you will object to this argument, okay? It is known that the function d square is the sum of a c-infinite and a concave function. So it's semi-concave, so it's like more like the singularity of a concave function. So why is it like that? In fact, if you just look at the function, x goes to x minus y squared minus x2, you do the computation, you realize it's an affine. So if you take the infimum over all y, you get that d squared, distance squared to c minus norm of x squared, is concave. Okay? So the distance squared is indeed the sum of a concave and a c-infinite function. And therefore, we should rather expect that the singularity to be the singularity of a general concave function. Now, for a general concave function from R into R, the singularity is of phi are the jumps of the derivative. You have only countably many jumps, and usually they are dense. But a locally connected countable subset of R has only isolated points. It cannot have dense. It cannot be dense in any subinterval. Okay? So that puts a lot of restriction on the set of singularity, much more than you would expect just from knowing that it is locally semi-concave. Okay. Now, in fact, there is also a global topological property for every bounded connected component U in RK minus C, the inclusion of the singularity into U is a homotopy equivalent. Okay, so we have a local property and a global property. In fact, this global property was known already. It was proved in 2004 by Lyotier, okay? And Lyotier is a computer scientist, but a French one. So there is a real proof in the paper, okay? And why were they interested in that kind of things? It's because they reconstruct from the singularity of the distance the shape of a domain in RK, okay? So the set of singularity is called the set of medial axes for the people in computer science, and they reconstruct, they use the set of, you know, of singularity to reconstruct the domains, okay, from in images. So in fact, we can also, by our proof, give a version of the global homotopy theorem for non-bounded connected components of RK minus C. The answer cannot be so easy. For example, if C is convex, you have only one unbounded component, connected component, and of course there is no singularity there. Okay, in fact, this is a particular case of a general result on singularities of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation on viscosity solution. So this is, I'm going to treat the evolution case, which is the one I need for the distance, to get a simple proof for the distance. So you just look at the Hamilton-Jacobi equation in evolution form. And what I'm going to say is valid for Tonelli Hamiltonians on manifold. I will tell you what is a Tonelli Hamiltonian. So I'm supposed that M is a complete Riemannian manifold. And I am assumed that it has a complete Riemannian metric. And I will denote the associated norm, as usual, by norm at x on the tangent bundle, on the tangent fiber at x. So, and I will use the same notation for the cotangent bundle. So a point in the tangent bundle will be denoted by xv. X is a point in M, and v is a point in the fiber. And we will denote the Riemannian metric, the Riemannian distance associated to the Riemannian metric by d. So if you do not feel at ease with manifold, you can always assume that M is Rk, and or if I need no compactness, or M is, well, is a torus when compactness is necessary with the usual flat Euclidean metric. Okay. Now, as I said, I will suppose that H is a Tonelli Hamiltonian on the cotangent bundle of M. So what does Tonelli Hamiltonian mean? It means that the Hamiltonian H is at least C2. It is C2 strictly convex. The second derivative in the momentum is definite positive everywhere. Now, because I'm assuming that my manifold is not compact, I'm going to ask that H is bounded on sets where the momentum is bounded. And I'm going also to assume superlinearity. So the function H is bounded below on TM and grows faster than absolute value of, sorry, it's under norm of P uniformly in X in M. So the prototype example is, of course, you know, kinetic energy plus potential energy. So in fact, in 2005, when I was giving that course that Alessio attended, each time I would repeat that I was using a Hamiltonian which satisfies all these four conditions. It was quite annoying every day to, every time to repeat it. And one day, I went to Campo Santo. So I went to Campo Santo and I started to walk around, and suddenly, what do I see? The grave of Tonelli. So that was an order from the god of mathematics. They should be called Tonelli Hamiltonian. And since then, I think the world has caught up and everybody calls them Tonelli Hamiltonians. So I am assuming that U is a viscosity solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, and I'm going to address the topological structure of the set singularity of U, which is a set of points where Tx, where U is not differentiable, in a case where H is a Tonelli Hamiltonian. Now, suppose that U is uniformly continuous on every subset 0t cross M with t positive. Then if U is a viscosity solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, the set of singularity is locally contractible. So this is a general result about solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Okay, and I restrict to the case where U is uniformly continuous because I'm allowing M to be non-compact, and I'll explain the reason later why I have to assume here uniformly continuous. Okay, it's also possible to give some indication on the global homotopy type, not of U, but of the singularity of U. Okay, we need to introduce the Aubry set. So Aubry set is an object that comes from dynamics and not from PDE. And I need to introduce the Lagrangian to explain you what it is, so I'll do it a little bit later. So first version of the work appeared in a note of a compte-rendu a year and a half ago. So what is the important feature of Tonelli Hamiltonian that we use is that a Tonelli Hamiltonian has an associated Lagrangian, and therefore we can define action. So, and once we can define action, we can also give a formula for solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is the Lax-Olenick formula. I'm going to explain that. So the Lagrangian associated to the Hamiltonian is defined by the formula called the Fenchel or Fenchel-Moreau formula that I suppose here in Pisa I don't have to explain too much. So the Lagrangian is also Tonelli, meaning that it's C2 strictly convex and uniformly superlinear in V. Okay. And of course, if you start with the Hamiltonian kinetic energy plus potential energy, the Lagrangian is kinetic energy minus potential energy. Okay, what is the action? Well, the action is, if you have a curve which is differentiable, you look at the values of the Lagrangian on the speed curve of the curve and you integrate them. Okay? Now, the action is always finite, unless the curve is not differentiable, in which case you would put plus infinity. And Tonelli's theorem states that for a Tonelli Lagrangian, given any two point, you can find a curve which minimizes action between the two points in a given time. Okay? So it means that you can find a curve gamma, which is C2, and such its action is less than the action of any other curve with the same endpoint. Okay? So we call such curves, of course, minimizers, and in fact, minimizers are as smooth as the Lagrangian. This is part of Tonelli's theorem. Okay, so the picture is like that. Gamma is a curve, okay? I don't know if you see something. Well, anyway, I can just do it like that, suppose, yeah? So you have a curve. Its action is smaller than the action of any other curve with the same endpoints. Okay. So what is the Lax-Olenick semigroup? Here it's rather the negative Lax-Olenick semigroup because there is also a positive one. So if U is a function, let's say, with values from minus infinity to plus infinity, I can define T minus T of U by the formula T minus T of U at X is the infimum of the action of gamma penalized by the value of U at the beginning. And the infimum is taken over all paths ending at X. Okay? And we will define T minus zero of U equal U is the identity. So in fact, this family is a semigroup defined on the space of all functions on M which are minus infinity plus infinity valued. This is a negative Lax-Olenick semigroup. In fact, it's probably better to try to do the infimum process there in two steps. First, if we fix two points x and y in M, we can define ht of xy by the infimum of the action of all paths going from x to y in time t. And therefore, we can also define the Lax-Olenick semigroup by just this formula now. We are taking t minus t u at x is the infimum over all y in m of u of y plus ht of yx. So, in fact, you are more interested in real-valued functions. So, if we have a real-valued function being bounded from below for t minus t of u is not a problem if the function is bounded from below. Okay? And of course, if the function is not everywhere plus infinity, the function t minus t of u will never take plus infinity as value. So here is a simple case where t minus t u is finite everywhere. It's a case where the infimum of u is not minus infinity, and u is not identically plus infinity. When m is compact, it is not difficult to see that t minus tu of x is finite at some point. If it's finite at some point, then necessarily u itself is finite. Okay? And therefore, in fact, if you are finite for t minus t of u at some point, you are finite everywhere, and the infimum of u also is finite. Now, when M is not compact, I don't know a necessary and sufficient condition to ensure that T minus T of U is finite everywhere. I don't know one. I know a sufficient condition, I gave you one, the infimum is less, is not minus infinity, but I don't know a necessary condition. necessary general condition. So let me come back to function u with values minus infinity plus infinity. And the Lax-Olenick evolution is a function of the variable tx, which is dash t minus t u at x. Okay? Look at it as a function of 2. Two variable on 0 infinity times m. So there is a connection between viscosity solution and the Lax-Olenick evolution. It's well known for compact m, in fact, that they are the same thing, essentially. For non-compact manifold, or in the case of RK, here is a statement that gives a connection. So suppose that you have a viscosity solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is uniformly continuous on every subset, 0t cross m, then in fact u is given by the Lax-Olenick formula, okay, where of course the function little u that you consider is as the restriction to 0 cross m. So for m equal rk, you can find a proof in a paper of Hitoshi Ishii. Basically, this is the case where you can do the maximum principle, okay? You doubling argument and so on. When m is not compact, you cannot find easily a maximum to apply the doubling argument, you need to find a maximum for something. So when it's not compact, you put conditions that will allow you to find the maximum to localize the problem. And I don't know any example of a viscosity solution which in the non-compact case, which is not given by the Lax-Olenick formula. I asked Hitoshi and he told me also that he doesn't know. Well, I don't know. I mean, if you take H, of course, Tonelli Hamiltonian. So there might be, I don't know if there are some solution, viscosity solution, which do not satisfy the Lax-Olenick semi-group. Okay, so this is one thing, and the reason why I asked u to be uniformly continuous in the set for to give you the global homotopy theorem or the other one is because, in fact, what we can do is prove things on solutions which are given by the Lax-Olenick evolution.
So if such an example existed,
you're saying that this would be non-unique? If you had such an example where it would not be allowed to run the function? No, I don't know, because it does not mean, so suppose the function u, the starting is completely wild, then you are not going to be able to show that the Lax-Olenick formula defines a finite function. Okay, I don't know. I mean, it just everything is open there. Anyway, the uniqueness argument, if you don't find a maximum somewhere, you cannot apply the doubling variable argument, and then you are stuck, whatever. I mean, you have to, in the non-compact case, you face a challenge. So usually in the viscosity theory solution, people assume everything is uniformly continuous to avoid it. This kind of problem. But I think it's an interesting problem to find out what happens if you do not have uniformly, I mean, if you have, what kind of things can happen, okay, if you suppress uniform continuity. Okay, second thing is a fact that I discovered in 2017. Suppose you have a Lax-Olenick evolution which is finite at some point t0, x0. So, okay, I mean, you have this formula, you take an inf over crazy set, or over M, which is not compact. It might be finite or not finite, but the fact that if it is finite at some point, it is finite everywhere at a time before, which is not difficult to see, but it's even continuous. Not only is it continuous, it's Lipschitz, locally semi-concave, and automatically a solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Okay? So if you look at this inf, there is no reason a priori where if it's finite at some point, there is another point at which it is finite, but when the Hamiltonian is Tonelli, there is a lot of rigidity in this kind of phenomena, and you get this theorem. Okay. So let me remind you that a locally semi-concave function is a function which is locally in a coordinate system, the sum of a concave and a C-infinity function, and for Tonelli Hamiltonians, locally semi-concave functions are solutions if and only if they are solutions almost everywhere of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, of course. So the main results now can be formulated for evolution, finite everywhere evolution of Lax-Olejnic semigroup. So suppose we have a function from M into minus infinity plus infinity, whose Lax-Olejnic evolution is finite everywhere on 0 to 0 cross M, then the set of singularity of U hat is locally contractible, so it's locally connected. It's kind of general result. Now, you may wonder why I do bother with functions which are not finite or not continuous. Bear with me, you will see why. Okay. And to give the homotopy type of the set of singularity of U, we have to introduce the Aubry set of U hat. So the Aubry set A of U hat is the set of points Tx in 0 infinity times M, for which we can find a curve parameterized by 0 to plus infinity with value in M, such that at time t it goes through x, and for any two times between, we have that the difference of value, sorry, here I should have inverted. Here there is a misprint. Okay, here the S prime and gamma, the value of gamma should be inverted. Okay, my functions are defined t first, x after that. So the difference of value of u hat between these two points is just the action of the path. So this is the definition of the Aubry set. And in fact, this set is a closed subset which is disjoint from the set of singularity. In fact, for every point Tx, we can find a backward characteristic in the case where we are, okay? So it's a curve which ends at x and satisfies the action condition. The difference of value of u is the action of gamma between any two points. So this is what is called a characteristic or a backward characteristic. So the Aubry set A of u hat, there should be a hat here, A of u hat, is a set of points for which we can prolong indefinitely a characteristic as a curve which is still a characteristic. So if u is the sum of a globally Lipschitz function and a bounded function, so I don't say that the bounded function has to be continuous, it's irrelevant, then u hat is finite everywhere on 0 plus infinity times m, okay? Not at 0, of course, not for 0, but away from 0. And the inclusion of the set of singularity into 0 plus infinity cross m minus the Aubry set is a homotopy equivalent. Okay? So this is the global homotopy type of the set of singularity. No, time plus infinity. Because time zero, you always have backward characteristic. The problem is that when you try to prolong it, you come to a shock, yeah? So now, these are the general theorem for Hamilton-Jacobi equations. And let me now give you something that an apparently unrelated consequence. So what I'm going to tell you here does not contain anything about viscosity solution or or Hamilton-Jacobi equation, of course. It's in there, but. So suppose that we still have a complete Riemannian manifold. Now, if you have 2 points in a Riemannian manifold, they can be joined by a complete Riemannian manifold. They can be joined by a minimizing geodesic. Okay? Sometimes they can be joined by a unique one, and sometimes they can be joined by more than one. So let me consider the pairs of points xy for which I can find two distinct minimizing geodesics. Okay? So I call this set NU, non-unique, minimizing geodesics. Okay? And I coined the notation, and it's only yesterday that Pierre Marco told me that this is what it really meant. For me, it was only non-unique related to him. But he said it's very nice because it's non-unique, minimizing geodesic, the set of pair of points. Okay. So can you say something about that set of pair of points? In fact, this set is locally contractible. So if you take two such pair of points which are close, you can join them by pair of points for which there is non-uniqueness for the minimizing geodesics. Did you know that? No. I don't think it's something that you can think it's possible about it. You try to avoid thinking about, you know, sets of points which, for which there are two distinct geodesics. Like that, yeah? Especially if you do optimal transport. It's precisely the opposite. You want things for which you can only join by one object that connects the two. So we can say also something about the global topology of this set, NU of MG, and to keep things simple and to avoid, again, introducing you know, Aubry set and so on. Let me restrict to the case M is compact. So I'm going to call delta M the diagonal in M cross M. So if M is compact, of course, the set of, if X equal Y, you have a unique geodesic. I mean, it's a constant geodesic. So the set NU of MG is away from the diagonal. And in fact, the inclusion of this set in M cross M minus the diagonal is a homotopy equivalent. For me, that was kind of surprising that such a set would not depend on the homotopy type. I mean, its topology, global topology, does not depend on the Riemannian metric. See? M cross M minus the diagonal does not depend on the Riemannian metric. So this set of points, of pair of points which can be joined by two distinct geodesics, does not depend, at least when M is compact. When M is not compact, I mean, it's different, because you have the Aubry set that will come into play. And of course, for example, if you look at the sphere, well, you know a metric, the round metric, the pair of points for which you have two geodesics are the antipodal points, so this set is in fact a sphere. Okay? It's homeomorphic to the sphere, because once you know the first point, you know the second one. Okay? And therefore, for every Riemannian metric on the sphere, this set has the homotopy type of the sphere. I mean, why? Well, it's like that, but it's not something that you think is possible. You would really think that the topology has to do something with the metric. See, no curvature assumption, nothing. Just something which does not depend on curvature or anything. Okay, so how do we tie all this together? So I spoke to you about distance function to closed set in Euclidean space, about solution of Hamilton-Jacobi equation, and then about sets of pairs of points for which you don't have a unique geodesic that joins them. They seem like far apart things. Well, in fact, let me consider the simplest Tonelli Lagrangian on the Riemannian manifold. What is it? Well, it's the one defined by kinetic energy. Okay? L of xv is 1/2 of norm of v squared. Of course, the associated Hamiltonian is just the same one. In this case, in fact, if you try to compute the minimum action to go from x to y in time t, you find dxy squared divided by 2t. Okay? Why? Let's pick a curve between x and y, parameterized by time t, and you use the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to write that the distance square is less than the length square, is less than the energy, okay, times in the integral of the constant one. So you get 2t times the action of gamma, because there should be 1/2 here to get the action of the Hamiltonian. Okay? And of course, this is attained on the minimizing geodesic. Okay, so this proves that you have this kind of thing. Okay, now that I have that, I'm going to try. Now, I have h of txy, therefore I can write my Lax-Olejnic semi-group, and for this I'm going to do it for a closed set in M, and I'm going to apply that to the characteristic function, of course I'm going to modify this characteristic function and take the one that comes from convex analysis. It's zero on C and plus infinity away. Okay? So I'm assuming that C is not empty, or equivalently, the characteristic function is not plus infinity everywhere. Okay? And to compute its Lax-Olejnic transform, I just have to take infimum over all y in M of the characteristic function of C applied to y plus ht of xy, which is dy x squared divided by 2t. Okay? If I take the infimum, of course, for the infimum, I shouldn't care about the value where this is plus infinity, okay, because it will give me plus infinity, so it does not contribute to the infimum. And therefore, I just take the infimum on the set of points which are in C. So I just get the square of the distance to C divided by 2t. Okay? Therefore, the set of singularity of the Lax-Olejnic evolution of the characteristic function of C is just 0 plus infinity times the singularity of this square C. Okay? Now, this square C is differentiable everywhere on C. I mean, it's flat to order one. And therefore, the singularity of this square C are the same as the singularity of DC, which are away from C. So now I can apply the general Lax-Olejnic formula to the evolution psi hat psi C, I forgot the C here, okay, and its singularity set is precisely 0 plus infinity times the singularity set of DC away from C. So I know from the general theorem that this set is locally contractible, of course, that will tell me that the set of singularity of DC is locally contractible. Okay? Because the 0 plus infinity, if you have a product which is locally contractible, every factor is locally contractible. Think of it in terms of locally path connectedness. If you have a product which is locally path connected, than each factor is, of course, I mean. I'm not going to say that this is a proof that 0 plus infinity is locally path connected, but at least for the other one, yes. Okay. So I'm going to, try to avoid problems defining Aubry sets. And now I can give a generalization to compact Riemannian manifold of Lyotier's result. In fact, the compact case was already obtained by Albano, Canarsan, Guyen, and Sinestrari. few years ago. So if you look at the set of singularity of the distance function, as it's a subset of M minus C, and in fact the inclusion is a homotopy equivalence. And this again follows from the general global homotopy theorem applied to the Laxolenic evolution of the characteristic function. Okay, so it's a particular case. Well, the distance to a subset is the same as the distance to its closure. Okay? And of course, I mean, I don't want to say anything about the points which are in the boundary of the closure. About that. So now I'm going to connect this to the set of non-uniqueness of minimizing geodesic. For this, let me consider the product. Okay, I consider the Riemannian product, so M cross M with the Riemannian metric G cross G. Okay, the sum of the two Riemannian the two copies of the Riemannian matrix. And the diagonal is a closed subset of M cross M. So if I just look at the characteristic function of the diagonal in M cross M, I know that the Laxolenic evolution, but for M cross M, okay, is the distance to delta M square xy divided by 2t. Okay, it's just the general computation I did for any closed set. Okay? But if you just do a simple computation for the minimization, you just realize that this function is equal also to the distance square xy divided by 4t for t positive. Okay? So what you have done is, by this simple computation, you connect the distance of a point xy in m cross m to the diagonal with the distance between x and y. And therefore, you get that the set of singularities of the distance square, okay, on M cross M is the same as the set of singularity of the distance to the diagonal. Okay? Well, I mean, there is no square here. Remember, I don't want to consider. I mean, if I put the square here, I would get. I just forget about the asterisk, okay? So I just get, so these two are the same, therefore I can apply my general theorem in that case, okay? But what are the singularities of D square? Well, they are precisely the pairs of points where you have two distinct minimal geodesics, okay? And therefore, the set NU of MG is nothing but the set of the singularity of D square, which is nothing but the singularity of the distance function to delta M away from delta M. So this implies that this set is locally contractible, okay? And the theorem about the global homotopy for the distance function to a compact set implies the second result, that the inclusion of the non-uniqueness set into M cross M minus the diagonal is a homotopy equivalence. Okay. So I tied all the things I mentioned. And now what I would like to do is to give you proof, at least for the case of a closed set in RK, streamline the proof we have given for the general Hamilton-Jacobi equation, okay, to this case where it takes a very simple formulation. Now let me say a few things about the distance. Of course, the distance of x to c is always attained by a point c in c, and the set of points in which it is attained is called the projection of x into c. Okay, so this projection is always unique if and only if c is convex. So usually, you have several projections. Okay, you may have several projections, like on the picture there. And as is well known, there is a strong relationship between projection and differentiability of DC. The function distance to C is differentiable at x, not in C, if and only if x has a unique projection. And in that case, you can give the gradient in the following way. You call Cx as a unique projection, okay? And then the gradient of the distance is x minus Cx normalized, okay? So as a corollary, in fact, you can prove that the function, if you take a point x away from c and look at one of these projections, cx, then any point in the segment between cx and x has a unique projection, which is cx itself, and therefore the function is differentiable on each one of these segments. Okay. So how do you prove this theorem? You introduce the following function, phi of ys. If y is fixed in Rk and also s is fixed, I define the function phi of ys in that way. Phi of ys of x is the distance square of x to c minus 1 plus s divided by s norm of x minus y squared. Okay? Claim this function phi of ys is strictly concave and goes to minus infinity when x goes to infinity. Okay? So this follows from, I can rewrite this term here as the sum of x minus 1 squared and 1 divided by s x minus 1 squared. I have the minus sign in front. Now I just develop this, and I get, the first two terms, the difference between d squared cx minus norm of x minus y squared. I just get d squared cx minus x squared minus 2yx minus y squared. Okay, and this one remains what it is. But this term here, we have already seen that it is concave. Okay? I am subtracting this term as a function of x. This is a linear term. So this is concave. And now subtracting a multiple of x minus y squared makes it strictly concave. Okay? So this function is indeed strictly concave because you just... This one is concave. The first part of the sum here is concave. And you subtract from it x minus y squared divided by s. So this is a function which is strictly concave, and of course also it goes to minus infinity because this concave function is dominated by a linear function, and you subtract a quadratic term, goes to minus infinity. Okay? So you have now a strictly convex function which goes to minus infinity as x goes to minus infinity. So what can you do? Okay? It has a unique maximum. Strictly concave function which goes to minus infinity when x goes to minus infinity, the unique maximum. So you can call this maximum f of ys. Now we are having a homotopy now. That's it. This is the homotopy that will do everything. So let me explain a little bit about that. I think I have another 5 minutes. So if I compute the value of phi of yx at y, I just get distance squared to y. And therefore, if I look at the point where the maximum it is attained, I just get the distance squared at f of ys is bigger than this term for x equal f of yx plus a value of the function, okay, which is this one. So in particular, f of y, the distance squared at f of yx is larger than the distance at y. I can also use that the distance, because the distance to c is one Lipschitz, I just get that the distance of f of ys to c is less than the distance of y to c plus the norm of the difference between the two points. And if I just do the computation, replace here by this term here squared, clear out things, at the end I end up with norm of f of ys minus y is less than 2s distance of c to y. So I got two inequalities, this one here and this one here, okay, that I just recalled here. And this two inequality plus the uniqueness of f of ys that I did not mention here implies that the following three properties are true. The uniqueness implies continuity away from zero. On the other hand, you see here that this formula tells you that f glues with the identity at s equals zero in a continuous way. Okay? And it tells you, of course, also that you are stationary if you are on C, and also that you increase, I mean, you don't, do not decrease distance to C. Okay? Therefore, if you start away from C, you will remain forever away from C. So it's not only a homotopy of RK, but it's a homotopy of RK minus C. I need another property, which is a slightly more involved argument that I will skip, is that if DC is differentiable at f of yx, then y is on the segment between the projection, the unique projection of f of yx to C. There is a unique projection because the distance is differentiable at f of ys. Okay, the function is therefore differentiable at y because it's in the unique segment, and in fact you can compute the distance of f of ys as 1 plus s, the distance of y to c. Okay. Now, these are the properties that allow me to prove everything. Well, the property four, maybe I should say that, okay, so. So if I start at a point which is not a singularity, I can never enter a singularity. Yeah? Because of that, if I arrive in a singularity, in a point where it's differentiable, then I am differentiable at the start. Okay, so this is propagation of singularities, global propagation of singularities. Okay? But it's a global propagation of it's not a it's also a global propagation into singularities. It is what is even more. So let me now get to Lyotier theorem. I give you proof of Lyotier theorem. So from the property three, of course, as I said, the homotopy remains, I mean, if you start in RK minus C, you remain in RK minus C, and therefore, because the homotopy follows a path, if you apply the homotopy in a connected component of R minus C, the homotopy remains in that component. Okay? So we have F induces a homotopy of U into itself, and now suppose that we have a bounded connected component. The supremum of the distance of this bounded connected component is finite. Now, if I just look at property four, it tells me that if I am differentiable at a time, fs, so at f of ys, then I'm differentiable at y, not only, but also I increase the distance. Okay? So I cannot increase too much that distance, okay, because I remain in U and the distance is bounded in U. So as soon as 1 plus s distance of y to c is strictly larger than k, then f of y s must be in the singularity. So f of y s takes you to the singularity, provided you have this inequality here. 1 plus s distance of y to c is strictly larger than k. Okay. Therefore, in particular, I can take s as k divided by distance of c to y, and then I just get the inequality, and therefore I can define the homotopy by g of yt is f of kt divided by distance of c to y. So this is a homotopy of u, which starts at the identity and ends inside the singularities, and takes the singularities into the singularities. So it's a homotopy. Okay, it shows you that the inclusion of the singularity in U is a homotopy equivalence. Okay. Well, okay, maybe I don't have really time to sketch the local result, but it's not much more complicated to prove the local result. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Do you have questions, comments?
It's very simple. No? It's a very simple question, but what happens when you put a boundary on your manifold? Can you repeat most of these, or you have to assume the boundary is totally geodesic, or whatever?
Which part do you want?
I don't know. I mean, it's just for example, the results you have mentioned on the sets of non-uniqueness, right? These topological properties are very interesting. So one may wonder if there is an analogous for, I mean, just for the full case with the boundary.
I mean, okay, in this case, you have to assume the boundary is nice. Yeah. So there are differences. If you assume it's strictly convex, so if you have 2 points in the boundary, does the geodesic stay on the boundary or goes it inside? I mean, you can. But basically, the whole point is that this is a set of. What you can do is just add a color on the boundary and try to get to the non-compact case. And if you know, for example, that it is convex, then okay, I mean, you will get. That the set of, I mean, the same problem once you extend, or you can try to generalize the Hamilton-Jacobi theorem to the case with boundary, but then you see, I mean, if you have Hamilton-Jacobi with boundary, then you have to look at boundary conditions also. Mm-hmm. It's not, so I mean, yes, you can do, but then things become a little bit more complicated because your function is not, I mean, for example, if you look at a simple Lagrangian, which is just the norm, okay, so you can try to solve Hamilton-Jacobi equation with boundary value for that, okay? But the problem is that as soon as you put a function which is not a constant, you are creating new phenomena in terms of Aubry sets and things like that, okay? So there is answer, but then I have to look at each case. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Thank you. More questions? Seems that there is no one, so let's thank Albert again, and we have a coffee break. So welcome back. It's a pleasure to introduce Nicola Gigli from CISA. He will give a talk about functional analysis and metric geometry. Thank you.
Thank you, Luigi. Alessio, it's difficult to add something to what everybody already said about you. Now, I want just to say that congratulations. that the strength, the energy and passion that you put in whatever you do, I think for me has been always an inspiration, and I think not only for me. So thanks for you. And one other thing that I want to say is that while I finished to prepare my talk, I was realizing that while my connections with PISA never really ended, I mean, my collaborations with Luigi Ambrosio have been ongoing since, well, ever. I think that this is the first time that I give a talk here at the math department. So I was realizing that, 20 years ago, I was in some room here learning what were vector spaces or groups, and I can see some of my professors there sitting in the audience. And here we are today celebrating the impressive achievement of a young brother, so that's quite emotional. So thanks also to the math department for having helped organizing this conference. Now about my talk, you know that the Fields Medal is not only an award for the achievements of the single mathematician, but also in some sense an encouragement to continue doing great research in the future. Now, while I don't think that Alessio needs this sort of encouragement, I think it would have gone on anyway, so I decided in this talk to speak not only of something that I've done, but also of a project in the future. So maybe this conference maybe will bring some good luck in this direction. So let's see. So functional analysis and metric geometry. For me, metric geometry, at least in the sense of this talk, is geometry of metric spaces having some curvature lower bound. Okay, so not just geometry of random metric spaces, but where some curvature property is sitting over there. And I will insist on some functional analytic aspects of the study of this type of geometry, something which entered the field, I would say, more or less like 5 years ago or so, no, maybe a bit more, but whose role is ever increasing. So, let's see. I will start recalling what metric geometry is for the purpose of this talk. And I will give an example of applications to the smooth setting of these non-smooth studies. So perhaps, I would have loved to give you more, but there is no time. I just chose one. And then I will speak about a closer look to this functional analytic aspect of the theory. So metric geometry. Here is an analogy that you see everywhere when one speaks about metric spaces with some curvature lower bound. You can find this example in the book by Burago Ivanov, entitled Metric Geometry, or on Cedric Villani's book Optimal Transport, old and new in the part where he studies lower Ricci curvature bound. So here is an analogy, and I will play a lot with this analogy during my talk. So consider the concept of convexity. Now you have a smooth function, well then you have two ways of speaking about convexity. Either you check whether the Hessian is positive, or you check the convex inequality. Okay, there are two, in speed, extremely different ways. So one is the differential point of view, the other one is the integrated point of view. But they're equivalent in the smooth setting, okay? And of course, this point of view has its own advantage, so the differential point of view is easier to verify, right? So if you have to check whether a function is convex, 99% of the time you compute two derivatives and that's it. And of course, it comes with, a straightforward calculus rule. So if you want to, to check whether the square of a positive convex function is still convex, again, what I would do is, take two derivatives and see if the correct sign is there. The integrated point of view, so to say, carries other advantages. So first of all, is much more of a stable notion. So if you have a sequence of, functions, convex function in the sense of convex inequality, which converge, say, pointwise to a limit function, then it's trivial to check that the limit is also convex. The same thing is harder to check for the differential point of view because a priori you can lose the regularity needed to establish that notion. And then, of course, it's a basis for a solid calculus, and of course, it captured the true essence of convexity, right? So to the point that we define convex functions as those where the convexity inequality holds, not those with Hessian or negative. Okay, so far so good. That's, we all know about this. Now let's come to an analogy about where we leave the world of functions and the second order bound on the derivative, on the function. And let's go to the setting of shapes. So here is a topological theorem. And I hope you capture the analogy with this business of convex functions. So take a smooth Riemannian manifold. So for me, a Riemannian manifold will always be smooth, complete, and connected. Then the following two are equivalent. The sectional curvature is non-negative everywhere at every point. And let me say this in word, geodesic triangles are fatter than triangles in the Euclidean space. So in formula, this means that whenever you pick a point x and a minimal geodesic yt, the distance between x and yt is bigger or equal than, well, what would be the distance if we were on, say, R2? Having a triangle, the distance between y0, y1, xy0, xy1 are, on R2 the same as they were on the manifold. Okay? So you see again, we have a differential inequality which is entirely equivalent in the smooth setting to a kind of an integrated inequality. Okay? Now, much like for convex function, one might, take this as a good starting point for defining what it is for a non-smooth structure to have non-negative sectional curvature. And that's what Aleksandrov did. So an Aleksandrov space is a metric space which is complete, geodesic. So geodesic means that for every two points, there is a curve which minimizes the length and whose length is exactly equal to the distance between these points. And for which these, the inequality written above, which is, where triangles are fatter than the Euclidean space, okay, in the same sense as in the manifold. Okay. Now, this is the definition of non-negative sectional curvature in the sense of Aleksandrov, but this can be generalized to sectional curvature bounded from below by any real number. You just replace the Euclidean space with either the sphere of appropriate radius or the hyperbolic plane of appropriate negative curvature if you want to compare different kinds of geometries. Okay, so that's for sectional curvature lower bound. What about Ricci curvature lower bound? So here is a theorem which has been mentioned also, I guess, yesterday in the talk of Robert McCann. It's a theorem due to Stumme and Vorenes, but which relies a lot on earliest work of Otto Villani and Cordero Rasken, McCann, and Smukas Lager. And the theorem does the following. So take a smooth Riemannian manifold, again, complete, connected. Then the following are equivalent. The Ricci curvature is non-negative everywhere. And the relative entropy relative to the volume measure is so-called geodesically convex in the Wartenstein space. So this Wartenstein distance has already been mentioned. It is the distance on the space of probability measure, which comes by the optimal transport problem with cost equal distance squared. Okay, so you take any metric space, and then naturally, thanks to this optimal transport problem, you have a natural distance on the space of probability measures on that space. And which is geodesic as soon as the base space is geodesic. So Riemannian manifold as a metric space is always a geodesic, so geodesic space, so is the space of a probability measure on a manifold. And once you have a geodesic space, you can wonder whether a functional on the geodesic space is convex. That's exactly what McCann was doing yesterday with this kind of complicated distances that you were using. So you have geodesic, so you can wonder whether each time you compute your functional along a constant speed geodesic, whether it satisfies the convexity inequality or not. Okay? Now, if your functional, in this case of manifold, is the relative entropy computed with respect to the volume measure, so this is the Boltzmann entropy, integral of rho log rho for a measure whose density is rho, then this convexity of the entropy is equivalent to a lower bound of the Ricci. Okay? Or non-negativity of the Ricci, actually. Okay? So again, it seems like a good idea to define what it is a metric measure space to have a Ricci curvature non-negative, provided the relative entropy with respect to the reference measure that we chose is convex. Okay? Let me emphasize that in this setting, you can't speak only of metric space. You really need also to add the measure to the structure. And this is the measure that you use in order to compute the relative entropy. Okay? Now, it can be that your metric is so nice that it has, a well-defined, nice Hausdorff dimension, and then maybe the measure is the Hausdorff measure, but that's not strictly necessary, okay? It could be a bit more decoupled. And as much for the sectional curvature lower bound, this definition can be generalized to what they are called generic curvature dimension condition. So this is CD, KN condition, where the first number K is the lower bound on the Ricci curvature, and the second number, n, is the upper bound on the dimension of the space, in some analytic sense. Okay. So the definition that they've wrote there would be the definition of CD zero infinity space. So no negative Ricci, and I'm not saying anything about dimension. So could be plus infinity. Okay. These two notions, these two say non-smooth notions of lower section or lower Ricci curvature bounds are linked. This is not trivial, but they are fully compatible. So in the smooth setting, if you have a Riemannian manifold of dimension n whose sectional curvature is greater or equal than k, then by definition, the Ricci curvature, which is the trace of the sectional, should be greater or equal than k times n minus 1. Okay? And that's the same, I mean, this kind of compatibility is present, a bit much less trivial, even in the non-smooth setting. So, so in Alexandrov space, always has, with curvature bounded from below, the Hausdorff dimension is either a positive integer or plus infinity. That's not too hard to check. And if it is a positive integer, well, then you consider as measure the Hausdorff measure, and what turns out is that the space is CD n minus 1 k n, so with the sharp kind of bounds. Okay, very well. So. Now, I said that one of the features of the definition of convexity via convexity inequality was the stability with respect to weaker convergence than C2 convergence. So we might expect that this sort of stability is present even for these integrated versions of curvature bound al Alexandrov or Lotz-Thurn-Villani. And this is the case, but first I have to tell you what do we mean by weak convergence in this setting. So here it is. I will give definitions for in the compact case. So say that we have a sequence of compact metric spaces, and then we say that this converges to a limit compact space in the Gromov-Hausdorff sense. So GH stands for Gromov-Hausdorff over there, provided you can find a big metric space Y and isometric embeddings of all these metric spaces into Y. And once you look to your spaces inside this bigger one, you have a convergence in the Hausdorff sense, in the Hausdorff distance. So the Hausdorff distance between two subsets of a metric space is the following. You look for the, you have two sets, A and B. You look for the least R such that the R enlargement of A contains B, and the R enlargement of B contains A. You can always find such list R, possibly plus infinity, and that's the Hausdorff distance. So, and Gromov-Hausdorff is, okay, I try to embed my metric spaces, as closely in the Hausdorff sense that I can, and if I have convergence after the embedding, then I declare that my metric spaces were converging. Now, if rather than a metric space, we have metric measure space, we don't look at the Hausdorff distance of the space, but rather look at the weak convergence of measures in this embedding. So we embed, again, isometrically all our spaces into this big Y. We carry with us the measures. And whenever there, after having carried the measure, we have weak convergence in duality with continuous and bounded functions on Y, then we say that the metric measure structures are converging. Okay. So one should really think this kind of weak convergence as a kind of analog of weak convergence for functions. So in some sense, it is easy to get compactness with this kind of convergence. But even if you're starting objects where smooth Riemannian manifolds, limits typically can be non-smooth. Okay, and I guess, so a good example of this kind of behavior is the following. So imagine a cone. Okay, a cone has a tip where it is not smooth, because it's a cone. But you can imagine that you can smoothen a little bit the tip of the cone and obtain something which has positive curvature over there. Okay, and if you smoothen it less and less and less, you are converging in some sense to the cone. Okay, and this sense is in this Gromov-Hausdorff or measure Gromov-Hausdorff sense according whether you put or not this volume measure on this manifold. Okay, and moreover, you might suspect that. Okay, so whenever I smoothen the cone, I obtain something which has non-negative curvature everywhere, okay? And then I pass to the limit, and you can wonder whether in some sense, even if the limit object is not smooth, whether it remembers, of being limit of something with positive curvature. And this is indeed the case. You can check that the cone is an Alexandrov space, for instance, of non-negative curvature, okay? So that's a kind of basic example of what can happen with this sort of convergences. And now about compactness. It is a rather trivial fact for lower sectional curvature bounds and a bit more complicated to check for lower Ricci curvature bounds that these notions are stable with respect to respective convergence. So Gromov-Hausdorff for metric spaces and measure Gromov-Hausdorff for the Ricci part. And moreover, as shown by Gromov, if you couple either one of these conditions with an upper bound on the dimension properly formulated according to the setting, and an upper bound also on the diameter, the resulting class of spaces is compact. Okay. So in particular, actually, Gromov's theorem is you take the set of Riemannian manifolds with dimension less or equal than something, diameter less or equal than something, and Ricci curvature greater or equal than something, then this class is precompact in the Gromov-Hausdorff sense. So together with the closure of this notion, which has been proved by Lodström and Villani, you get this compactness result, more or less. Okay. Very well. So. So far, so good. So here's the picture that we have so far. So I drawn this scheme. I will play a lot during my talk with this scheme. So on the top line, we have these sort of smooth inequalities that we're looking at. So non-negativity of the Hessian, non-negativity of the sectional curvature, non-negativity of the Ricci. Of course, in all these cases, the fact that I chose non-negativity rather than greater or equal than a number is just, for simplicity, but you could generalize this. And on the lower row, the relative sort of integrated inequality or non-smooth or synthetic version of the inequality, so the convexity inequality, the fat triangles inequality, let me say so, and W2 convexity of the relative entropy. Okay? Very well. So far, so good. Now, here is perhaps one thing that we should check before being completely satisfied with this formulation, which is the following. In the theorems by Topogonov and by Sturm-Vorenes, the assumption is that the manifold is smooth and Riemannian. Okay. Now, in the conclusion, of course, smoothness is not necessary, but Riemannian has also been lost. Okay. So one can wonder if this is bad or not. So the point is that there are smooth structures which are not Riemannian. In particular, these are Fiesler structures. So a Fiesler manifold is like a Riemannian manifold, but on each tangent space, you put a norm rather than a scalar product. Okay, so the relation between Fiesler and Riemannian is the same as Banach and Hilbert. Okay, so that, but these are perfectly, they can be as smooth as you wish, and these are perfectly reasonable smooth structures. So one can wonder whether they appear or not appear in this Alexandrov or Lodström-Villani setting. And here there is quite a big difference in behavior, because it's a quite a simple exercise to check that if you have a Fiesler manifold, so it's a smooth Fiesler manifold, which is an Alexandrov space, well, then the Fiesler manifold is actually Riemannian. Okay? In some sense, so why this is simple? Because for normed spaces, this is really trivial, because you check this fat triangle inequality, and this is the parallelogram inequality. And once you have a parallelogram inequality, that's sufficient to enforce parallelogram identity, and therefore you come from a scalar product. But on top of this Alexandrov condition is stable by Gromov-Hausdorff convergence. So you pick a point of your Fiesler manifold, you blow up, and you converge in this Gromov-Hausdorff sense to your tangent space, and therefore your tangent space should also be Alexandrov, and therefore Riemannian, and therefore end of the proof. Okay. On the other hand, a more delicate result is that if you take RD with the Lebesgue measure and the distance coming from any norm, so the prototype of a Fiesler structure, this is always a CD0n space. So this is the last theorem in Villani's monograph of about 1,000 pages on optimal transport already. Okay? So Fiesler structure are included in this Lodström-Villani business. Okay? And one can wonder whether it is possible to, in some sense, restrict the attention to, just Riemannian kind of structures, but including this non-smooth setting. So one would like to, get a refined notion of lower Ricci bound where this Fiesler structure is not included, but the notion is still stable under this weak kind of convergence. Now, we have an answer to that, but in order to give the answer to that, I will first need to recall one definition, the definition of a Sobre function over a metric measure space. So this is something that many in the audience already know, but I also see a lot of young faces, so let me spend a couple of words on this. It might come as a surprise that even in a very non-smooth setting, like a generic metric space, a complete separable equipped with a Radon measure, non-negative, one can define first-order Sobre spaces. So this is criminal linear, there is no integration by parts, at least it's not clear how one would define that. But still, it is possible to speak about Sobre functions. I restrict my attention to the case of W12 Sobolev functions. And let me tell you in advance that the fact that I'm looking W12 and not at W1p is related to the fact that in the lost in the Sturm-Voronoi theorem, the distance, the vastest time 2 distance appears. If they formulated the theorem with the vastest time p distance, I would be looking here at the W1q subless space with the Holder conjugate. But given that, I mean, the theorem was formulated with 2, let's stick to 2. Okay. Now, the definition of subless functional metric measure space has been first attempted by Hayuwash, who gave a notion which now is not anymore that used, the notion that actually is more widely used came later by Cheeger, and then Shanmugalligam, and much later Ambrosio Savarin and myself sort of revised the formulation. So here is more or less the definition by Cheeger. So first of all, you define, for a real valued function, you define the local Lipschitz constant, which is an entirely metric concept. The local Lipschitz constant of a function f at a point x is just the Lim sup when y goes to x of f of y minus f of x in absolute value divided by the distance between x and y. So that's a metric formulation of how much is the variation of the function in a vicinity of x. Okay? If x is isolated, say that this is 0. Okay? Okay, then the measure enters into play, because what do? We take a Lipschitz function, we integrate this local Lipschitz constant squared, And this is our first approximation of our Dirichlet energy, but the true definition is that we should take the L2 lower semicontinuous relaxation of this function. So the Cheeger energy of a function f is 1/2, just for normalization purposes, and then you take among all the sequences of Lipschitz functions fn converging to f in L2, you take the LMINF of the integral of local Lipschitz constant squared. Okay? If we are on RD, this results in the Dirichlet energy functional. Okay, so it looks like kind of is a possible reasonable generalization to the non-smooth setting of this Dirichlet energy. We call this Cheeger energy, well, first of all, because this relaxation procedure has really been proposed by Cheeger at first, and also to this, because this is not a Dirichlet form in general. So this does not satisfy the parallelogram identity. Okay, and this is reflected on the fact that, so what would be the subless space? Now, the subless space W12 would be the set of functions where this Cheeger energy is finite, and its most natural norm is, you know, the Sobolev norm squared would be the L2 norm squared plus, well, twice this Cheeger energy. Okay. Now this space is always a Banach space, but not necessarily an Hilbert space. Okay. And by the way, if you work on RD with a norm, this is a Banach space, and this Hilbert if and only if the norm comes from a scalar product. Okay. Now, finally, I just mentioned this without proving. If you have a Sobolev function, and you take a sequence of Lipschitz functions which is optimal in the definition of this Cheeger energy, so it realizes the inf, then the associated sequence of local Lipschitz constant converges strongly to a limit function, okay, which is non-negative, and it's called the minimal weak upper gradient, and denoted by this modulus of the f. So this plays the role of the modulus of the distributional differential. So in this setting, we don't have the differential yet, but we still have its modulus in some sense. Okay? And for instance, the Cheeger energy is exactly 1/2 the integral of this guy squared. So it provides kind of a pointwise information for this Cheeger energy function. Okay? So now this comes quite natural. I mean, we can say that a metric measure space is infinitesimal Hilbertian, provided W12 is an Hilbert space. And we can decide to, you know, enforce this Lost Sturm-Villani condition by adding this infinitesimal Hilbertianity, okay, to get a stricter class of spaces. Now, a few comments on this definition. So first of all, as I already mentioned, in the smooth category, infinitesimal Hilbertianity singles out Riemannian manifolds out of Finsler 1, so at least it goes in the direction that we were kind of looking for. So n-dimensional Alexandrov spaces are infinitesimal Hilbertian, and this is, okay, this is not entirely trivial, relies on subtop properties of Alexandrov spaces, but perhaps what I want to put the accent here is that infinitesimal Hilbertianity is not a stable notion under measure Gromov-Hausdorff convergence. Actually, if you take the closure of infinitesimal Hilbertian metric measure space, you obtain all metric measure spaces, okay? And this non-stability, you can see it, heuristically speaking, I see it as follows. So measure Gromov-Hausdorff convergence is a kind of zero-order convergence. There are no derivatives appearing there. While infinitesimal Hilbertianity is a first-order notion in some sense. And now you cannot really believe that a first-order notion is stable with respect to a zero-order convergence. So that cannot work. But if you couple this infinitesimal Hilbertianity with a second-order bound, like this CDKN condition, then the resulting notion is stable. Now, this is far from being trivial. In fact, it is the result of a quite long and intense research program, which, took me busy for a few years. And let me mention that, so these central papers by Ambrosio Savarin and myself have been a kind of a turning point of the theory. In particular, the first word is were an attempt at enforcing this Lo Sturm-Villani condition with some Riemannian kind of condition has been given. But I also want to, you know, take a moment to say that even though these papers are central, and one other thing is that how do you get this stability of this RCD condition? Well, the key word here is heat flow. Okay, so one study is the heat flow in this non-smooth setting. Heat flow is very on RD is very much related to the Dirichlet energy. So there is a notion of heat flow even in metric measure spaces, which is very much related to the Cheeger energy. And for those of you who know a bit about Wasserstein world entropy and Jordan Kinderella dot scheme, you also know that you know, the gradient flow of the relative entropy with respect to the Wasserstein space is also the heat flow. So this is what bridges between this Sobolev world and this Lo Sturm-Villani setting. So it is a topic which in particular has a lot to do with gradient flows in metric setting, okay? And perhaps also because of this, you know, these central papers by Ambrosio Savarin and myself are those which are most commonly referred to when speaking about infinitesimal Hilbertianity and RCD condition. But I want also to say, to take a moment and say that, I mean, of course, papers should be always, you know, the content of the paper should be always related to what was coming before. And this paper by myself, Kuwada and Dota had many of the ideas that have been developed later on. And in particular, on that paper, the contribution of Kazumasa Kuwada, which tragically passed away less than 1 month ago, was crucial. And I want to sort of say loud and clear that without his contribution and these ideas, there simply would not be the theory of RCD spaces as we know it today. So let me move on. Very well. So here is the picture, sort of the revised picture, which now takes this Riemannian condition into play. So below this condition of non-negative Ricci, we added this infinitesimal Hilbertianity. Okay. Now let me give you an example of application of this non-smooth business to the smooth world. And so let me start with a classical theorem in geometric analysis, which does the following. So harmonic functions on smooth Riemannian manifolds are certainly smooth. You mean you work in coordinates and you know, you have elliptic operators and everything works. But what I want to put the emphasis here is that you can get estimates on the Lipschitz constant of an harmonic function on, say, half of a ball, just in terms of a lower Ricci curvature bound on a manifold and upper dimension bound. Okay, and so this constant CK dimension of n is where the geometry of the manifold comes into play. For the rest, the inequality is like the one you would have on RD. Okay, and let me prove this inequality. It's rather, I mean, morally, the technique is morally simple. So one starts from the Bochner inequality. So this inequality that I've wrote, Laplacian of grad f squared over 2 greater or equal than grad f grad Laplacian f plus k times grad f squared, is in fact is true on manifolds with Ricci curvature bounded from below by k, and in fact is equivalent to having a lower bound on the Ricci curvature by k. So if you have that at every point for every smooth function, you have that if and only if the Ricci curvature is greater or equal than k. Okay. Now, if your function is harmonic and you apply this inequality, then of course the midterm with the Laplacian disappears, and you get that the Laplacian of grad f squared over 2 is greater or equal than k times grad f squared. So call g the function grad f squared. So this inequality is telling that the Laplacian of g is greater or equal than twice kg. Okay. So for instance, if k is 0, this tells that g is a subharmonic function. And now elliptic regularity theory kicks in. And the Mosier iteration argument tells you that the function g must be bounded from above. Oh, sorry. And I mean, if you look at what the inequality is telling, coming from Mosier iteration, is precisely that g is bounded from above by actually square root of g is bounded from above by this right hand side that I wrote over there. Okay. And so Mosier iteration works. What you need, you know, I mean, the constant that appears in Mosier iteration are the doubling constant and the constant in the Poincaré inequality, and both of these are. Can be controlled by lower bound on the Ricci and then upper bound on the dimension. Okay, so that's a classical result. Now here is the question: can we improve this estimate? So we have Lipschitz bounds. Can we get quantitative, say, C1 estimates on harmonic functions? So just a little bit more, right? So Lipschitz is the gradient is bounded. Can we, you know, quantify the continuity of the gradient? Or perhaps, so look, I'm also willing to give you a lower sectional curvature bound if that is needed. So can we improve? And the answer turns out to be no, as it has been recently proved by Guido De Filippis and Jesus Nunes in Brown. And I want to tell you the proof, I mean, or the outline of the proof of De Filippis and Zimbron, because I think it's very nice and it gives you an idea of what you can do with this non-smooth business. Okay. So Ambrosio and Onda proved a couple of years ago that harmonic functions are stable under convergence of RCD spaces. Okay, intuitively, this is due to, so if you believed me a few slides ago when I said that the heat flow was stable under Gronwasser convergence and lower Ricci curvature bound, so stability of the heat flow is more or less like stability of the Laplacian, and that's more or less the stability of the harmonic function, heuristically speaking. That's more complicated than this, the proof, but the idea is there. Okay, so if I want to prove that there are no quantitative C1 estimates depending on lower curvature bounds, it is sufficient to provide an example of limit space of manifolds having uniform curvature bound where the harmonic functions are not C1. Okay? And now there are two observations that are crucial. So the first is that if you pick a cone like the one I was describing before, so really a kind of a cone with a tip which is not smooth, harmonic functions will have zero gradients at the vertex. Okay, I don't have a cheap explanation for that except that, you know, harmonic functions would like to be as smooth as possible. Now, smooth at least means, so the very beginning would mean that you are linear on the tangent space, but if you're on the tip of the cone, your tangent space is still a cone, so it's not a vector space. And the only hope for you to be linear on a space which is not a vector space is that you have to be zero. Now, Guido is telling me that maybe this is not the best way of presenting this, so I apologize. So there are computations over there that I don't want to get too much into. So keep this as a fact, okay? But what is interesting is that this is regardless of the amplitude of the angle. So the angle could be as close to 2 pi as you want, but still any harmonic function has zero gradient over there. Okay, and then the other observation is that you can find a convex subset even on R3, which has a dense set of these kind of conical singularities on its boundary. Okay, and the boundary of any convex set on RD is an Alexandro space with a curvature bounded from below. And in fact, it's also a limit space because you can, in some sense, modify your set and obtain your non-smooth one as a limit. But so end of the proof, right? Because certainly there are non-constant harmonic functions on that set. You just solve the Dirichlet problem with non-constant boundary condition, and you obtain a harmonic function which is not constant. Now, if the function was C1, the gradient would be continuous, but the gradient we just said that must be zero on a dense subset. So the gradient would be zero everywhere, but this is not the case. Okay? So end of the argument. Now, if you think that this kind of way of thinking is bizarre, crazy, unusual, or too complicated, I sort of invite you to reconsider your position in light of the following example. So we all know that, you know, differentiable functions must be continuous, right? So we can wonder whether a bound on some bound on the gradient of a function can give us some bound on the continuity. So for instance, question: we know that we have a smooth function, smooth, compact, and supported. And the question is whether the fact that the integral of grad f squared is less or equal than 1 tells us something about the modulus of continuity of f. Does it? Well, actually, no. And I mean, I guess that quite a big chunk of the audience should have thought, wait a second, there are Sauber functions which are discontinuous. Like, we all know that. Okay. So you see, there can't be, so you can get a uniform modulus of continuity out of the control of the Dirichlet energy. Because if you add such modulus of continuity, this would carry over on the limit, and also be true for Sauber functions. Right? And this is the same argument that De Filippis and Zimbron used in the non-smooth world. It's really the same, right? So if you're looking for, counterexamples to regularity, it's easier to check that where things are not regular, okay? And one thing that I like about this is that, so there are other examples of applications to the smooth setting of this non-smooth business, but one thing that I like about this is that I didn't speak at all in the statement about measuring Gronwasser convergence or proximity. So there is nothing like that. So the kind, so think about the case of Sobolev function. So the kind of answer that one has in mind is that, so the question is about the smooth world. So the function is infinity with compass support, okay? And the kind of answer that we all have in mind, because we know we already studied functional analysis, is okay, wait a second, let me introduce the Sobolev space with convergence of functions and blah, 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 blah. I take the limits of smooth functions and there I can find examples which are relevant to my case. Okay, so this is kind of the same business. So we are interested in smooth manifolds with some curvature bound, and it is natural to look at, you know, the compactification of this set of manifolds. As I hope, I mean, I can convey with this example, which I like a lot. Okay, so we've already seen this functional analysis which comes into play through this infinitesimal Hilbertianity, but let me sort of insist a little bit more on this. By insisting on this analogy with convex functions, because even in non-smooth world, there is another completely different way of speaking about characterizing convexity. You can say that the function is convex provided it is continuous and the distributional relation is non-negative. Okay? So provided we introduce a different way of speaking about Hessian non-negative, in this case a weak distributional sense, and we add some continuity statement which allows us to link this weak formulation to a pointwise formulation, we obtain a notion which is fully equivalent to the convexity inequality. So this requires no smoothness of the function, okay? This statement. Of course, the distributional point of view, in some sense, retains at least some of the advantages of this, calculus perspective. So you get an Hessian, right? If you start with the distributional point of view. Of course, it is more technical. So we don't learn distribution in the first year of university. So here's the picture, the revised picture. What I would like to promote with this talk is that maybe we can, add a third line and start speaking about the distributional approach to lower curvature bounds, even in a non-smooth setting. Okay. So I want to propose you something about these question marks that are sitting in these lower reach and lower section of curvature bounds. In fact, I think that we do have already a distributional approach to lower Ricci curvature bound. And what I want to propose is something that maybe works for lower sectional. So to speak about lower Ricci, I need to tell you one thing more about a calculus on infinitesimal Hilbertian spaces. And, well, the thing is that if you have an infinitesimal Hilbertian space, then by polarization, basically, by polarizing this minimum weak upper gain, you can obtain something which you may call scalar product of grad f, grad g. Okay, there is something to check to be sure that this is a linear form, but it actually is. Okay, and once you know what it is grad f grad g, by integrating by parts, you know what it is a Laplacian, right? A function is a Laplacian provided integration by parts works for any test function in W12. Okay, and with this said, here is what I think we can call a distributional approach to lower Ricci curvature bounds. That's in a paper by Ambrosio Savarin and myself. So a metric measure space is RCDK infinity, provided the following four conditionals. So the first condition is something about the volume of big balls. You can forget about it. So think about compact spaces, and that is automatically satisfied. So that is a kind of a technical condition. The second condition, let's call it Sobolev to Lipschitz property, and it does the following. So whenever you have a Sobolev function whose weak upper gain is less than one everywhere, or almost everywhere actually, then such functions admits a one Lipschitz representative. So this is something that, for instance, on RD works, right? So that's why we say that W1 infinity is coincides with Lipschitz functions, basically it's because of this property. Then the space should be infinitesimal Hilbertian, and the Bochner inequality should hold in the weak sense. So now we can give a meaning to all the objects appearing in this inequality, even in a non-smooth setting. Okay, so we can wonder whether that inequality works. Okay, and if it does, okay, I'm being a bit sloppy in how we give meaning to that, but if in some weak sense this holds, then we have an RCD K-infinity space. Okay, let me continue playing a bit with this analogy with convex functions. So the first condition, well, forget about it, but the second condition is kind of the continuity thing, right? So something which links the distributional perspective to pointwise statement. And the third and fourth condition, infinitesimal Hilbertianity and Bochner inequality, are in some weak distributional sense the analogous of Riemannian and lower Ricci bound. Okay? Very well. So what do we do with this? So this theorem has been generalized to RCD KN spaces, I mean, in various settings and directions by Herbert Cuvadet-Sturm, Ambrosio Mondino-Savaret, and Cavaletti-Milman, finally, a few years ago. Okay? So here's the picture that we have so far. So we sort of complete, and the only thing that is left is the world of sectional curvature over bounds. Well, let me say that typically, so on Alexandrov geometry, in some sense, by the very definition, there are many concave or semi-concave functions. So distance function to points are semi-concave functions in the Alexandrov space. And they kind of they are the basic of a very sophisticated calculus, because, you know, as soon as you have concavity or convexity, then you are a good place in order also to perform some kind of second order analysis, because convexity, that's what it is. While function analysis, the function analytic viewpoint is not really present that much in this setting. So I hope at least that we can do something with this tool coming from the lower Ricci business. But in order to do so, I need to develop a little bit more calculus on this non-smooth setting in order to make a really full use of this distributional approach. And in some sense, we need to. I mean, at some moment, it's not anymore sufficient to have the modulus of the distributional differential and just the scalar product of grad f, grad g, without really having, the differential, the gradient, vector fields, and these kind of things. So we do have now, and in order to define what is a vector field or covector field on a metric measure space, I need first to introduce a mathematical structure that is called L2 norm del infinity module. So what is an L2 norm del infinity module is a Banach space equipped with two additional structures. So the first is this Banach space should be a ring on L infinity in the very algebraic sense. So we should have a linear map from L infinity across M to M. We satisfy, F times GV is FG times V, and 1 times V should be V for any L infinity functions F and G and any element V of our Banach space. And moreover, it should be L2 normed. What does it mean? This, we should have a map, which I shall call a pointwise norm, which is a map going from our Banach space to the space L2, which is non-negative, is local in the sense that the pointwise norm of FV is equal to the absolute value of F times the pointwise norm of V whenever F is an L infinity function and V is an element of the Banach space. And I can use this pointwise norm to recover the global norm in our Banach space. So I take the L2 norm of this pointwise norm and I get back my original norm. Okay? So why such a notion? So where does this notion come from? So the basic example is you take the space of L2 vector fields on a Riemannian manifold, and that is naturally an L2 norm del infinity module. You have a pointwise norm, you can multiply L2 vector fields by the infinity functions, they form a Banach space, so all properties are there. And more generally, the space of L2 sections of any normed vector bundle on any Riemannian or Fiesler setting, they also form naturally an L2 norm of an infinity module. So now the idea is, in some sense, to keep in mind that, so even in the smooth setting, you can fully describe a bundle by either telling what the fibers or telling what the sections. This is in a very, in a very deep sense. So there is this very famous Serre-Swan theorem, which is much like a meta theorem. So in many settings, these two points of view are really the same, even in the very abstract categorical sense. So we can take advantage of this later viewpoint and, forget about trying to describe what is the tangent space in a weak sense at every point or whatever, but just telling, what is an L2 section of the tangent or cotangent space. Okay. So this definition, so in fact, I shall think to L2 norm del infinity modules like this space of section of some bundle which is not really given, okay? So that's the basic idea. And the basic theorem or definition here is the following. So you take an arbitrary metric measure space, then up to isomorphism, there's a unique couple, L2 T star X and D, where L2 T star X is an L2 normed module, which I will think as the cotangent module, so where the notation, and D is a map taking subreal functions and returning elements of this module, which has two properties. First of all, whenever I take a subreal function, I compute this D, which of course is the differential in this setting, and then I compute the pointwise norm, what I get is the weak upper gradient of the function as before, so first property, and second property, I pick all these differentials of functions and they generate the whole cotangent module. So I take L infinity linear combinations of them and these are dense. Okay? And aptoisomorphism means that, you know, if you have another couple with the same property, then there is a unique isomorphism which makes this small diagram commutative. So either you take the differential in one sense or in another, they, you know, transform into each other through an isomorphism which carries over to these cotangent bundles. Okay? So now this works on arbitrary metric measure spaces, but if you are on an RCD, so in some sense that theorem tells, but this was widely known, so it's another viewpoint on the fact that metric measure space possess, in some weak sense, a first-order calculus, okay? That's trivial, right? We know what are Lipschitz functions on them, so there should be something of first order. Now, RCD spaces are spaces where a curvature bound is present, so a second-order condition is present, so maybe we can hope to develop a second-order calculus of them. And starting from this definition of cotangent modulus, sort of working hard on it, we can build a second-order calculus on RCD spaces. And the particular objects which can be defined are, you know, not anymore first-order Sobolev functions, but second-order Sobolev functions, which come with an Hessian, okay? And now second-order function, you know, it's a function as an Hessian, is like saying that its gradient has a covariant derivative. So if you believe that there are functions with an Hessian, you should also believe that there is the Sobolev space of vector fields which have covariant derivative in L2. And similarly, differential forms which have exterior differential in L2. Okay? And finally, if you look now not anymore at the Buchner inequality, but to the Buchner identity, you have, thanks to this first part of the slides, Hessian, covariant derivative, and exterior differential, you have basically all the terms in the Buchner identity except the Ricci curvature. Okay, so you can use the Buchner identity to define the Ricci curvature, and this turns out to be a measure-valued operator which is bounded from below by K in the very natural sense. Okay, and this controls the geometry of the space. Okay, now let me give you an example of application of this. There's a theorem by Hahn and Mirkchan, which come after some computations done by Sturm and relies a bit on these calculus that I showed. Which, well, I present a simple case. In fact, quite too simple, to be honest, but let me say it anyway. So take an RCD K-infinity space. Take a Sobolev function which has Hessian bounded from below. Okay? I'm being a bit vague, so I should tell you what do I mean by this inequality in this setting, but let me say so. There is a way of, you know, translating this inequality in this setting of modules. And then consider the new space where you perturb the measure by this factor e to the minus f, which is maybe, as you've seen in yesterday's talk about mechanics, quite of a common thing that you do. So if you perturb a measure by x minus f where f is convex, your Ricci curvature overbound improves. Okay? Then the theorem by Hahn and Mirkchan tells that this is the same, actually happens with the same kind of constants, even in non-smooth settings. So a lower bound by capital K on the Ricci plus a lower bound by small k on the Hessian gives you, by combined, a lower bound, you know, capital K plus K on the Ricci curvature for the perturbed space. Now, to be honest, what's the proof? The proof is, well, you run the computation, okay? So you start with how you check how Sobolev functions are modified, how the Hessian is modified, vector field, Ricci curvature, and end of the proof. Okay. Now, to be honest, this is not the only proof. So in this case, the transformation is so simple that you can work even directly with the Lostrum-Bilani condition in some sense. So this is quite a bit of a cheating. But you can perform more general and more complicated transformation, like conformal transformations, and still you can carry on this kind of calculus and see how these lower Ricci curvature bounds are perturbed in this non-smooth setting, okay? So this theorem by Hahn and Mirkchan gone quite almost unnoticed I had the feeling in the community, but it's really one of the first results where you take a non-smooth setting, a non-smooth space, you perturb it, and you can, you know, still say that it satisfies the, you know, your kind of lower curvature bound. And this is kind of, so to me, this looks like really a nice example of this metaphor of the nut of Grothendieck, right? You know that Grothendieck used to say that when you have a nut, to open it, you have two ways. Either you take a hammer and you try to crack it, or you leave it just close to the sea, you wait for the water to rise, and at some moment, you know, the nut becomes wet, and so wet that it opens by itself. Okay, so he was used to say this by saying that, well, we have a problem, you should rather than trying and, you know, solving that problem directly, you should build the theory all over it, and in some point, the problem will not be there anymore, right? So, and that's in some sense what happens here. So if you try to see how, you know, Lostrom-Villani condition gets perturbed after a conformal transformation, you go nowhere, nowhere. So there is no chance that you can compute this. While on the other end, you slowly build the calculus, and at some moment, you do the computation, and that's the proof, okay? So let's have a look to the sectional curvature lower bound of the story. Let's look to the smooth setting. Take a Riemannian manifold, let's say with a negative sectional curvature, and take a function which is smooth and convex. And consider the graph of this function equipped with the metric coming from the embedding into M cross R. Well, then this graph, which is still a smooth manifold, still has non-negative sectional curvature. Okay? Proof. You run the computation. So, I mean, you have everything, right? You have the manifold, you have the function, you compute, and the tensor, the lower sectional curvature is bounded from below. Now, and apparently, this is the only proof. So there is no trick around this, okay? Except in very particular circumstances. So the question makes perfectly sense even in the Alexandrov setting. You can have an Alexandrov space with sectional curvature bounded from below. A convex function makes perfectly sense. You take the graph, you take the intrinsic distance in the graph. So the question makes perfectly sense. And nobody has any idea how to give an answer. And when I mean nobody, I mean in particular, that, among others, Perelman worked for years in this business, and before turning to Poincaré conjecture and Ricci flow. And this seems untractable. And from what I understood by speaking a bit with the people in the community, is that apparently, running the computation is the only thing that, the only proof that is currently available, and there is no sectional curvature in the Alexandrov setting. So what I was thinking is, with this business of Ricci curvature, we are a bit farther ahead in this lower Ricci curvature bound, so can we, perhaps create, and moreover, we know by Petrunin and Zhang and Zhu that Alexandrov spaces are also RCD spaces, so can we, make use of this technology developed in the Ricci world, also in the sectional world? So the answer is that I have no idea, but let's see. But I have a plan, okay? So the plan is that, to use this distributional calculus developed for RCD to study lower sectional curvature lower bounds, and in the following sense. So the basic observation is that on RCD spaces, in fact, we not only have a Ricci curvature tensor, but we can really define in a distributional sense a full Riemann curvature tensor. How? Well, if you think in the smooth setting, the typical addend in the definition of Riemann curvature is a term given like grad x, grad y, z, the scalar product w. Okay. Now, multiply that by f and integrate against the volume measure. Then after integration by parts, you get no more than one derivative per vector field. Okay. We had two, and then we integrate by parts, and we get one here and one there. But we have many vector fields with covariant derivative in L2. Right? So that means that for many vector fields and many functions, this right-hand side makes sense. Right? So we can say weakly what it is, the same for the other various terms. So we can give a weak meaning to the full Riemann curvature tensor on RCD spaces. Okay? So in particular, we could wonder whether the associated sectional curvature is bounded from below or not. Okay? So now the hope. So here is the conjecture. So let me state it in a comment. So so take a metric space. Then possibly the following are equivalent. This metric space is an n-dimensional Alexandrov space with curvature bounded from below, or the metric space with the n-dimensional Hausdorff measure is an RCD kn minus 1 n, and this is Petrunin and Zhang and Zhu already tell us something, but plus the sectional curvature tensor is bounded from below by K in this distributional sense. Okay? I'm quite convinced that this conjecture should be true. The actual proof, I think, if true, will take still years to develop, because if you think about it, proving this conjecture would be basically proving Topogonov's theorem in the setting of RCD space. Now, Topogonov's theorem is not an art theorem, but still smoothness plays, quite a crucial role. And now, which is exactly the thing that, of course, we don't have here. So it's complicated, and still techniques have to be developed. But if true, this would bring a few benefits. So the first is that perhaps we could solve this. So it seems reasonable that we can solve this conjecture about Alexandrov space, but because then we would have a sectional curvature over bound in a very distributional sense on Alexandrov spaces, and then maybe we can check how it gets transformed. But perhaps besides that, it would really, you know, in a sense, put a strong bridge between this theory of lower sectional curvature bounds and lower Ricci curvature bounds, which so far have been, well, not entirely, but quite separated. So with techniques developed ad hoc in one setting and not really used in the other one. So I have no idea whether this will really be done in the near future, but okay, so that's it. Thank you. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Nicola. Our questions, comments?
So now that you have the calculus for, you have vector fields, right? And this differential and so on. So can you try to define, does it make sense to define the tangential divergence of one of your vector fields along, say, a smooth immersion of a two-dimensional domain and define minimal surfaces and minimal immersions and so on?
So, very nice question. So, I don't know. So here is the point. The point is that those vector fields by nature, these are elements of these L-infinity modules that I presented. And an infinity module, so an element of an infinity module by nature is something which a priori is only defined M almost everywhere in some sense, because, you know, because that's what happens with L-infinity function, so you're quotienting out in a visible sense. So in the general metric measure setting, you can't really speak of vector field, what is a vector field on a negligible set like would be on a you know, hypersurface. Yet, I'm working on a possibility which goes a little bit in that direction, but just a little bit, which is basically the following. So you know that even for Sobolev functions on RD, although a priori they are defined almost everywhere, then you work a bit and you realize that they are defined cap almost everywhere, right? So, and this is something that apparently one can do even for vector fields in this RCD setting. So these Sobolev vector fields, they are defined cap almost everywhere. And then, so thanks to this, you can hope to, you know, speak about what is a vector field on a hypersurface of codimension one, at least. So, so this goes a little bit in this direction. Let me also mention that recently Ambrosio, Bruet, and Semola gave adapted, let me say, the George's theorem about sets of finite perimeter on the RCD setting. So you can speak about BV functions, therefore you can speak about, you know, sets of finite perimeter, and then you can ask, you can wonder whether for almost every perimeter almost everywhere, total variation, you know, of the gradient of the characteristic function almost everywhere, the point you blow up in any way an hyperplane or these sort of things. And now when you handle a set of finite perimeter and maybe you want to integrate by parts to find some divergence formula on such a set, it is necessary to know what it is a vector field defined, you know, almost everywhere in the perimeter measure, and these kind of cap things, I think, can. So I don't know whether. We'll see.
It's correct.
But it's in some
easy way to.
Yeah, a natural development. But this is really, so their paper came out on CVGMT 1 week ago. This paper about cap things still has to come out. So we are working, and let's see what future will be.
So you can probably try to compute the first variation of perimeter with respect to these vector fields. That's the
exponentiation is a hard business.
So now we know what is the perimeter.
So you want to already take one derivative. No, but maybe, so of course, that's another thing too, yeah.
Any more questions?
Yeah, maybe I will.
Ah, okay.
So in some sense, all this theory you're developing now, it looks that you are going back to the origin in a sense, you know, all this theory was about having weak definitions which doesn't use calculus, and now you're able to go now to second order, so in some sense, maybe you can start to reproduce classical proofs and avoid all. So
in some cases, this already happened. So there are proofs that you say. Yeah.
Exactly. So at the beginning, there have been a lot of work to try to find robust proofs of theorems in Riemannian world that didn't work. And now, so do you believe at some moment, essentially, we could, like, I don't know, at some moment can you prove Cavalletti Mondino or something like that by computing asymptotic inequalities and stuff
like that? No, that's a very natural question. So it's unclear. So you know, we have. So it's good to have two points of view because you can use it. I mean, the one that you prefer in every situation. So and there are cases where. And I think perhaps you made a good example. So the example by Cavalletti Mondino is a place where I personally would not look for another proof because their proof is already so natural and beautiful and works so pleasantly in the not smooth setting that why should anybody want to modify it? So I mean, it's a very, you know, it works so well that. But anyway, so in general, I'm not sure. So if your question is. Can you hope to reprove everything, basically, without relying on geodesic convexity of entropy, and only in this say, definition a la, you know, that I showed you before, but I don't really think so. So, and perhaps the basic example is, so in order to prove that this distributional definition of RCD is stable, we have to pass through to Los Turbidani. So you cannot, so let me go back, perhaps. No, you know, this distributional, that's okay. Ah, so you say okay.
Space with this bound, then
so okay. So achieving that looks to me a bit too technically complicated. So I don't know. So I would more so complicated that I'm not sure I personally would like to sort of invest too much of an effort on that because that's kind of a mess. So to speak, you know, openly. But who knows? So maybe tomorrow some, you know, these young guys in the audience will, you know, prove me wrong, which would be great.
Any more question? Comment? I don't see any hand raised. Okay, so let's thank Nicole again.
Thank you.
Let me remind you that today we resume at 4 p.m., not at 3. So welcome back. It's a pleasure to introduce Juan Luis Vasquez from Madrid. He will give a talk about nonlinear diffusion equation driven by fractional operators. Thank you very much.
Per cominciare devo ringraziare il gentile invito per parlare in questo evento fantastico. Non è la prima volta evidentemente che sono venuto alla Spagna per godermi la vita in Italia, imparare un po' di matematica. Vi ricordo che la scuola normale mi aveva invitato a fare uno di questi programmi con congresso 2012. Ma questo è molto speciale perché celebriamo l'evento raro, medaglia Fields tanto giovane. Allora sono contentissimo di essere qua e per celebrare Alessio, come sei, tanti hanno detto cose fantastiche di te, io non devo ripeterle, solo dico, optimum non est mutandi, devi continuare come sei. In this general talk, I will speak about the things I have been doing for years. So much of what I say is known for many of you. Anyway, I've chosen to go this way of generality as many other people in the talks. So my main topic in this, I belong to the big group of analysts, whatever it is. And inside this enormous group, you have to do something different, particular. Your trademark, and my one is diffusion. And diffusion is very related to knowing the heat equation as the source of your problems. What do you want to know about things that are not the heat equation but look very much like it? And then there are two things that the first one I did for many years was nonlinear diffusion. And recently, which means the last 12 years, have been doing fractional diffusion. So since I was an engineer in my adolescence, many years ago, I mean centuries ago, I have this idea of projects. So my project is called nonlinear fractional diffusion. Now I will tell you something about it. And I will try to give some mathematical details. Probably will not get there. And some asymptotic behavior for the people who like functional inequalities. Okay, so let's try to do it. The main thing for a person like me is try to do a kind of mathematics that tries to solve problems that have a simple statement, and then they are difficult because mathematics is not simple. And the simple statement is, I want to understand diffusion. And the idea of diffusion is that there is a continuous medium, like a population, that spreads to occupy available space. So this is a physicist's definition. And if you look for motivation in physics, go to Wikipedia. There are like 20 main subjects that diffuse around, like fluids, chemicals, bacteria, animal populations, the momentum of viscous Newtonian fluid, and even diffusion in the stock market. So it's well recognized that diffusion is important for people in physics, and it has mathematics around. So the problem for me is, what is diffusion for a mathematician? And how do you analyze diffusion once you spotted the mathematics that had to be done? And this is the question that received two different answers. First answer is that diffusion for people in probability is essentially the very dignified and generalized way of talking about Brownian motion. So there are particles that, because of some interactions, jump from place to place. Normally, they jump from one site in a crystalline grid to the next site, next neighbor interaction, and they begin to do things around. And since you don't know why they move, it's like what Professor Brown described, you depend on probability. So you assign probabilities of moving from place to place and work out your mathematics about moving step by step, and you discover there are probability distributions that change with time. And this is a stochastic process, and the general idea about how to move from place to place in the continuous time and continuous space is not so easy. And this is stochastic processes, and in the sense of the particular kind called diffusion processes. And the Ito equation says that the increment of x, the probable increment of x, is one part is deterministic, given by a B, which is a vector field times dt, and another part is white noise with a certain coefficient sigma, which is the probability of moving around. And you go to probability, and I don't want to go. So there is another way for people in analysis. And in fact, one of the persons responsible for going from probability to analysis was Kolmogorov, the great Kolmogorov, one of the wonderful minds of the 20th century. And he discovered that if you do your calculations about going from step to step, what you get in the infinitesimal movement from 1t to t plus dt is the heat equation. Or in the case of generalized Ito equations, you get the variant of the heat equation. So you want to know about heat equations. And this double way of understanding diffusion is what everybody has been doing from that period until now, and it has two ways of going about the same subject. And we will follow the analysis, and in fact, we have to begin with the heat equation. And the heat equation was proposed much before people thought about probabilities in that sense. It was proposed by Joseph Fourier as an empirical description of the propagation of heat. And it was successful. So sometimes empirical laws are very strong in the sense that they find the right mathematics just per chance. And then mathematics can be done, and you a posteriori justify everything. So my basic idea is that once people know about the heat equation, you want to explain how many linear models are good to do the things we want to do. And are they linear or nonlinear? Can you do nonlinear process? What is the difference? And one of the main points in this menagerie, in this zoo of models, is how do you tell which model is relevant and which model is a variation? This is very important. Otherwise, you begin working on 224 models and there's no sense. There is one that is difficult and gets a difficulty. And the second thing is that even if you are going around with evolution equations, you realize that in the long run, probably these evolution equations will stabilize to an asymptotic state that will be more or less stationary. So you get to elliptic equations. Now, going to, from the parabolic to the elliptic equations is very important, and especially important in Italy, where elliptic equations are really the real thing. And in Spain, you can be parabolic or chaotic. In Italy, you have a tendency to be elliptic. And of course, the main operator you will find is the Laplacian. And one of the things that happened to me in the last 10 years is that we want to do non-local Laplacians, which are called fractional Laplacians. And this is a beautiful part of functional analysis that makes for interesting applications. And of course, as José Carrillo explained in his talk, you want to talk about complex systems by writing systems, where you introduce several effects into the equations, normally by writing several equations and combining everything and see what is the balance from everything. Okay, so there is a text that belongs to a summer course that we had in 2016 in Cetraro. I mean, I am like a pampered child of the Italian family. They invite me to things that I like. And this was organized by Bonforte and Grillo, two good friends in Italy. And the authors of this summer course were Carrillo, Delpino, Figali, Mingione, and myself. I could not believe it. So I wrote a whole book. It's a chapter, but it's a long chapter, explaining everything we had in mind about this idea. And there are other revolutions. So in this summer course, it was not one of the times where I met Figali when he was already widely recognized. But I remember that we met much before. He was a student in a course in Vienna in 2007. Maybe before we met, but I don't remember. I am very smemoriato. But in Vienna, he was a very brilliant guy and very, let's say, quiet. So you more or less didn't notice that he was around. In 2016, we noticed. And then there is a relation of this guy, Alessio, with Spain. And one of the happy moments was this summer course that we organized in Santander in this beautiful royal, former royal palace, La Magdalena in Santander. And then there is this picture that José Antonio showed yesterday, where we get this combination of two Fields medals, one of them a Fields medal with apparatus, which was Villani, and this guy here that was more or less pretending not to be himself. And I was here, and Bonfort is here, José Antonio is here, there are lots of you. Okay. And there are lots of Spanish co-authors. Since Begoña Barrios gave this presentation in the introduction lecture, I will rely on what she said. She's so good at explaining emotions. But there are all of the list of these people. Some of them are very good, and even myself, which maybe not. Okay, and the idea is that I want to report to you that Real Academia de Ciencias de España has nominated Alessio a foreign corresponding member of the Academy in December 2018. Bienvenido a nuestra Academia, querido Alessio. So this is everything we can do. I mean, we are happy. And let me tell you about the source of problems. The first thing is very easy. I get the heat equation, I get the properties, and I try to say, let me get another equation and try to do the same thing. So the heat equation was proposed by Fourier. It represents heat propagation and diffusion. So you can apply that to degrees of temperature or to densities of populations. And there are people in PDEs, functional analysis, dynamical systems, probability, differential geometry, working on that, apart from social science and engineering. And the idea that this equation is called a linear parabolic equation because it belongs to a big family now. And what is this family? The first step in the family is writing the linear parabolic equations in what you call non-divergence form. And you see that there are lots of small coefficients here that could be constants, but most probably they will be functions. And then you get a whole semester of working to try to get a basic theory with Schauder estimates. But in physics, they will tell you this is not, most of times, is not the right way of writing it. If the coefficients A, I, J are not differentiable, and this is something that Professor De Giorgi liked very much, and then you have to write the divergence form. And then there is another book, the divergence equations. So this is like a nightmare. It's the beginning of the bifurcation process that goes on forever. Every time you solve an equation, there is another member of the family bifurcating in another direction. So this is a linear theory that is very well known. And the point I want to say is that once you get this book, you discover that there are a number of concepts that you begin to understand that you can use because you have been introduced to them, like Gaussian function, which is the fundamental solution, separation of variables, Fourier analysis, spectral decomposition, Dirichlet forms, maximum principles, Brownian motion, generation of semigroups, functional inequalities, positive operators, entropy dissipation. And the point is that before you did this theory, you didn't know that these figments of the imagination could be defined. After you do the theory, you know that they are the thing that you need to do, and you will do it for another equation. So let's see how the heat equation proposes you the things you want to do. Take the heat equation in free space, and then there is this beautiful thing called the Gaussian kernel. But the Gaussian has an explicit form, and once you discover generality, you understand that you don't care about the explicit form. What you want to know is that this guy exists and has properties, and it is called the kernel. So all of a sudden you discover you need to know everything about kernels for linear operators. But again, the equation from the explicit form, you discover that it's similar. That means that it's invariant under groups of transformations. So then you get Lie theory in some sense helping you to do some geometrical evolution. Okay, this is enough. And then you discover that the maps that go from u t equals 0 to t equals larger than 0 make a semigroup of linear transformations in many different spaces. So you have a large choice of spaces where the heat equation is good enough, in particular all LP spaces. And then you think about, are all other equations generators of semigroups in all normal bank spaces? This is what you want to know. Regularity. The heat equation copies the regularity from the kernel because it's a convolution. So there is no problem with regularity. They are infinite even if the data are not. This is the very important property of regularization of the heat equation that is applied in image convolution to smooth images. Okay. And you want to know if this is true in general. And then there is this asymptotic behavior that made most of my life happy. If you get initial data that are not very bad, let's say compactly supported or going to zero to infinity, no regularity, and you make the evolution go, it will try to behave like the fundamental solution. And you may measure this difference in L1, and since the mass is conserved, you calculate this measure just as it is, and the difference goes to zero. On the other hand, if you calculate the L infinity norm, you have to be careful because the Gaussian go spreads, so it has to go to zero. So you take a weight that renormalizes back your screen. And this is something that the computer does for you. Putting the screen always to one, and then you see that the difference in L infinity of the renormalized screen goes to zero. And this is a very strong fact. Now, if you go to the French school of functional analysis, you discover that this beautiful theorem is not good enough. They want to know how quickly this goes to zero. And this depends on some kind of first eigenvalue of some kind of linearized problem that lies behind. And this is beautiful because this moves you to work and learn about Fokker-Planck equations. And you didn't know to do that, but if you are in France, you can do it. You have to do it. But we are not in France. Now, let me go for 1 second back to the forgotten field of probabilities. The heat equation is strongly regularizing, but the basis of the heat equation is making averages of probability runs of Monte Carlo trials. Every probability run is strongly chaotic. The regularity of these orbits is never Lipschitz. It's C1/2 minus. And this picture on the right and the picture on the left represent, in average, the same phenomenon. So strongly chaotic movements, in average, are strongly regular. And this is one of these contradictions of life that makes mathematics incredibly beautiful. If the regularity of the movement in the Markovian case is a bit better, the regularity of your equation is a bit worse. Because you have to trade off. The average is good when the things are very chaotic. Okay, so let's forget it and let's go to the nonlinear thing. For many years I did nonlinear things and the motivation was that I moved to Minneapolis and they told me, you know, Juan Luis, you're going to work on nonlinear equations. And I say, why? And they say, because. And that was it. Now, the nonlinear equations, according to the person who was my friend, a wonderful person, Jim Serring, was this monster. And this monster, if you look at it, seems to be the heat equation in disguise. So there are lots of letters around, but what I put here as H of U, which in physics is the enthalpy, in fact, it is dT of U in the linear case. But in the nonlinear case, it represents a Stefan problem. That is very important in practice. Second, the Laplacian is this term. And in fact, you split the Laplacian into the divergence of the gradient. And in the middle, you put a power. So then you make it nonlinear after splitting. And this is an incredible trick that is very useful in all the physical theories based on divergence operators. Don't manipulate the divergence. Put it outside because you have to integrate by parts to get conservation laws. Emmy Noether always living. If you want the conservation law, don't destroy your divergence. And then put the nonlinearities inside. And of course, B is the rest of the things that happen, like chemotaxis, reaction, convection, whatever. And according to Jim Serring, in the 1960s, when they posed this equation, they said, maybe in 20 years we'll write a book. So I was there in Minneapolis in 1980 and asked, how about the book? And say, maybe in 20 years. And I went there again in 2002 and I said, what about the book? And he said, maybe in 20 years. And then he died. So I don't know whom to ask. Okay. But the introduction to these things were written, there are two beautiful books by the what I call the Russian ladies, Ladyzhensky and Olejnik, the most prominent ladies in the 20th century mathematics. They wrote introduction to these elliptic and parabolic equations. And then, since the theory in general cannot be done, then you do something that people in the abstract realm do not like, but in the practical spheres we do, is concentrate on the problem that you cannot solve and forget the rest. And the problems in the list in Minneapolis were Stefan problem, Hilshow problem, porous medium, and evolution. So they told me, so 1, 2, 3, 4, choose one. And mine was 3, porous medium. And what is the point of porous medium? The power is here at the end, so it looks nice. But this equation with m is larger than 1 turns to be degenerate. and the pillar placing is also degenerate. Equations that are degenerate are not included in Ladigenskaya's book, in Oleinik's book, in Serring's book. They are different because they lack regularity. Regularity comes from some dissipation, and they have a very bad dissipation. So if you know about dissipations, you know that regularity comes from dissipation. And the dissipation here is quite bad. So you have to work a lot to prove regularity for these solutions. And this is what we did for many years. There is another way of doing nonlinearities, which is leaving alone the Laplacian and putting all your nonlinearities on the zero order term. And this, when p is larger than one, provokes blow up. And there is a huge community working on blow up. The most famous problem in blow up that is not solved is the Navier-Stokes. But this is a system. In the case of the equation, most of things are now known. There are beautiful problems, but they are very complicated. And in the systems, I will not say anything because Carrillo explained yesterday how to write the systems for chemotaxis. So let me go to the new things. Since I had been working on this nonlinear project for 20 years, and it was something that was big business, and we have reported several times. Of course, if you want to know something about this thing, you better ask Luis Caffarelli, who is master and commander. But there was room for everybody. I will tell you about the fractional diffusion. Now, what is the fractional diffusion? Many of you know already, but in case somebody doesn't know, and since this is a general talk, I will explain again. The idea is replacing Laplacians with fractional Laplacians. And the first question is there any motivation? Or are you doing because your thesis advisor told you to do it? And the idea is that in probability, when they run diffusion processes where particles move, think about the particles, from side to side, diffusion in the standard way is explained, look at numerics, by jumping to next neighbor. So it's just collision. A particle collides with the next particle, and they do something, so they move. And there is a probability of moving one step at a time. If you do this, you find the random walk, the standard random walk, in numerics. You pass to the limit when t, increment of t tends to zero, increment of x tends to zero, and you get, in the proper limit, the heat equation. And the idea is very important. What happens if, instead of jumping in your numerics, one side, you assume that you can jump 2, 3, 4, 5 sides. And you pass to the limit in the same way, you get the same heat equation. The heat equation is robust with respect to manipulating the side movement as long as the probability is confined to a finite range. You don't jump too far. Now, there are many phenomena in the modern world that are really very far away from this small range interaction. For instance, information in the global world. It is clear for everybody now that it is as easy for you, after finishing the talk, discussing one of the questions with your neighbor here, or starting an internet connection, going to Skype and talk to Bangalore. And more or less, the price is the same. So probability of talk to Bangalore is very large now. And you cannot rule out this possibility. There are many other examples, but information theory is one of the examples where long-range interactions are very important. And you cannot say that in the limit, you get the Brownian motion. In fact, Professor Levy, who was one of the three main probabilists in the beginning of the century, Levy, Wiener, and Kolmogorov, already saw that there is another cousin of the Brownian motion that is based on long interactions. He called it alpha stable processes, and they are called now Levy flights. And then you want to know what is the equation. I will write you the symbol because we like symbols. The symbol is ut plus fractional of u equals zero. What is the fractional? If you know some probability, you know that first you run the numerics. Then you pass to the limit and get your continuous process. Then you get the generation of the Feller process, the generator. The generator has an expression in analysis. This is the generator of the semigroup, this is the operator. But this looks like very far-fetched. For many years, people in probability were doing that and people in analysis didn't care. And all of a sudden, around 2000, things begin to move. And I learned about it from Professor Caffarelli in Texas. I arrived there in 2007 to work with him on some free boundary problems. He told me, you're not going to do that. I say, why? He says, because I say so. And so what I am doing to do? Fractional operators. I say, no. And then I did. So that was the beginning of my life. Now, what is a fractional operator? That's curious that once you know that you have to do fractional operators, many people in different branches of the same building know what it is, but they don't know that it is the same, or they don't care. I mean, if they pose the question, then a good mathematician solves the question. Oftentimes, the problem with mathematicians is that they do not pose the question. You need some kind of catalyst around, asking the question so people work. And the first definition of the fractional operator is given by Fourier analyst and says the operator after Fourier transformation has a symbol and is a multiplier that is just C square is the minus Laplacian. And you just put an S with an S. It's just the simplest solution. And this is called interpolation in Fourier space. Now, this is very good for people who do Fourier analysis, but normally people in PDEs work on bounded domains and do all kinds of things, and you cannot do Fourier analysis. And the coefficient is variable, so you want to have a formula for that. And now you invert the operator by making convolution. So the inversion of u hat is u, but the inversion of the xis to s is a very singular function that cannot be integrated, so the convolution doesn't have any sense. And now the convolution is just eliminating the ux here. Doesn't make any sense because the denominator is too singular. And the idea is that people in physics knew what to do. This is what you call a removable singularity. You add something to the integral to make it convergent. Remember that the variable of the integral is the y. You add a constant ux, and the difference upstairs may be compensated for the singularity downstairs. If you make a small calculation, this difference, if the function is Lipschitz, gives you x minus y to the 1. Downstairs, you have x minus y to the m plus 2s. If 2s is less than 1, you finished, right? So you are able to regularize the integral by writing this formula. And the problem is this formula the real limit that is compatible with Fourier analysis? The answer by Stein and all of the experts, and let me remember that Elie Stein died recently after a very fruitful and wonderful life. He was loved by everybody. And so thanks to Elie Stein, we know that these two things are the same. And this, what they call singular integral operator, works for a number of functions, in particular Lipschitz functions. So this is it. This is for analysts. You go back to the people in probability. And are they the same? In fact, the probability people say, run your Markovian process with certain weights that are the transition probabilities of stepping from site j at the k at the time n to site j at the time n plus 1. And assume that your probability, Markovian probabilities, decrease with time, no, with space, with a big tail, like a power, not exponential, not compactly supported, even not exponential, just a power. In that case, you go to the limit of your numerics and you find an operator by taking the generator, which is the probability of the difference between the initial step and the step after moving. This is very easy, and you get an operator. And the operator is the same operator produced by Stein. It is incredible. So all of a sudden, Luis Caffarelli came around and said, but I don't like this, because in one problem we have, we cannot do that. And they decided what we call the extension problem. extension problem is having a new variable called y on top of the x variables, where the original variables. In this new variable, you invent a new equation, which you call state equation. It's completely fictitious. It's like a new dimension. This is typical of the people in physics doing Kaluza-Klein models. One equation, one space with one dimension more. And then you say, my V is an extension of U to the upper half plane. Okay, once you have this new equation for a fictitious atmosphere that solves a kind of a Laplacian with a weight, then you take the Neumann data at the base, and this is the Laplacian. And how do you prove that it's Laplacian? Oh, because solving this equation with the weight can be done. In fact, Professor Fabes in Minneapolis had been doing that with some Italians called Serapioni and Chiarenza for many years. So they knew how to do it. And in the case alpha equals zero equals one, there is no weight. And it is the case of the half Laplacian. The half Laplacian, you solve upstairs the Laplace equation, you take Neumann data, and this is the half Laplacian. So it's the map that goes from Dirichlet to Neumann in this extension. And this is beautiful new idea that is a part of the thesis of De Silvestre with Caffarelli, a wonderful paper, 2007, the most important paper in that decade. For our community. And there was another paper by Stinga and Torrea in Spain, very related to that, but this is not the end of the story. So then another group came around and said, listen to us, we have another version. And this other version is that if you solve here inside the integral, the heat equation, make minus the initial data, do the Laplace integral with a certain weight, and renormalize it, you get the fractional Laplacian. This is amazing. All of these things are the same. So you have too many tools to do your analysis. Now you have to do it. There is a problem. If you do it in bounded domains, most of the definitions don't make any sense, or they are not the same. So this is incredible good news. It means enormous amounts of people working in defining properly fractional Laplacians in bounded domains and discussing like crazy and going for dinner. Sometimes the dinner can be very frustrating because one of the persons drinks too much and gets upset. But normally you don't drink too much and you become friends. And so there was lots of discussions about what is the real definition. There are two main definitions. If you want to do the fractional Laplacian in the bounded domain, you just do the same formula as time formula, but the x belongs to the domain. The y belongs also to outside. And what you do is you give external data for the f. So you calculate the Laplacian inside the domain, and you assume that outside f is known. And this is a very strange, curious idea, but suppose that f outside is zero. It's trying to solve an equation in Europe and assuming that the information from the rest of the world is frozen. And you want to know how much you pay for the interaction with the frozen outside. You have to pay for this interaction because it's there. And you are sending information to Tokyo to see what happens. Suppose you want to get the stock market information. And from Tokyo, they don't answer. From Bangalore, they don't answer. But you've spent some time in doing that. So this is a penalization of the external method. If you do that, you get the Laplacian, you can solve equations. But there's another way. If you go to the people in semi-group theory, you get this Laplace transform definition. You can do it in a bounded domain, who cares? And this corresponds perfectly to do Fourier analysis in a bounded domain with spectral decomposition and only raising the eigenvalues to the power s. So it's the most stupid interpolation that is based on diagonalizing your matrix, raising the eigenvalues to the power, and that's it. And this is incredibly strong for doing computations. Okay, so once you know that, you can solve the equation. Let's begin with doing that. The first thing, well, one of the things we did because of this systematic approach that I was always interested in, is trying to do the basic theory to see if there is any problem. So take the fractional heat equation in the whole space, take initial data in L1, and try to solve it. And Enrico Valdinocchi, who was very good at writing beautiful exposés of things, wrote a paper explaining how from long jump random walks, you go to this equation. And it's very recommended. Once you do that, you find that, according to some people in probability, Blumann and Couture, some very important people, there is an equivalent of the Gaussian function, which we call the Blumann-Couture generator. But it doesn't have an exponential shape. It decays like a power. And this is something that they proved, that this function that has a beautiful version in Fourier analysis, so you can invert it back, has this behavior as t tends to infinity, and this is what people in probability call a fat tail. In fact, fat tails were invented in Italy, according to history, by Vilfredo Pareto in some economics problems. So it's incredible, Italians are never quiet. Always, always making fun. Okay. And then Barrios Peral, Soria, and Valdinocchi wrote a beautiful paper to explain, even if the initial data of your equation are not L1 or LP, you can solve it because you know that in the heat equation, if the data grow exponentially, quadratic exponentially, you still can solve it. So they wanted to know something for mathematicians. Can you solve the fractional heat equation with large data? And this is called Wieder's theory. And they discovered that the growth of the admissible data is not exponential, it's a power. So we began with a game. We play about replacing exponentials with powers all the time that we can. And I liked very much this paper, and I proposed to Bonforte and Sire, two of my collaborators that we know, to prove the optimal existence and uniqueness theory. This was in 2016, and we were in Baltimore with nothing else to do. And we proved this beautiful, for us, optimality theorem. And you can solve the fractional heat equation if your initial data is a measure that can be integrated with respect to the typical tail of the fractional distribution. And in that case, there is a unique solution. On the other hand, if you have a unique solution that is non-negative, there is a trace at t equals zero that grows like that. So there is one-to-one correspondence. And the theory of the Wieder theory can be done. And then the typical thing is, can you prove that this kernel, the PT, the Blumann-Couture kernel, is attractive in the sense of the central limit theorem? And this is a theorem I proved also, just for the benefit of writing things clear, in 2018. It says that if you run the fractional heat equation with L1 data, they converge to the fractional Gaussian, the Blumann-Couture profile. Okay, so this looks easy. Let's go to the difficult thing. There are two models in this nonlinear thing that we call relevant. One of them is trying to understand what you put into the porous medium equation is something that is non-local. The porous medium equation says ut equals Laplacian u squared, to be simple. And you keep here the divergence, and u square, gradient u square is u gradient u. So in the porous medium equation I knew so well, there is a u here, and there is a u here, and that's it. So how do you invent a non-local interaction? And the idea comes from chemotaxis. The interaction potential is not u, it's a convolution of u with a Ries kernel. And this is how you construct what you call a non-local pressure. So this is a continuity equation for a fluid whose velocity is the gradient of a pressure, and the pressure is a non-local pressure produced by you. You can do that, and you try to solve it. So if you want to put that case minus Laplace and minus S, which is the risk kernel, you write it here, and this is the expression in all the symbolic glory. And this is This is the collaboration with Caffarelli that took like 7 years to complete. And the idea is that we got existence after much work. No good uniqueness. We don't get uniqueness up to now. And then one thing, we are honest people to a certo punto, senza esagerare. So we try to talk about to people, is it sure that this is the model? And they say, yeah, yeah, this is the model, but we don't have uniqueness. It's so bad for you. So we don't have uniqueness. It doesn't obey a maximum principle, so this makes life difficult. But it has solutions with compact support. Remember that this is porous medium. It is degenerate in the U. For U equals zero, it doesn't diffuse. But the pressure tries to move you because it's non-local. So who wins? Degeneracy wins in this case. It has compact support. And we proved very carefully that it has compact support. And there are free boundaries. Is there a regularity theory for the free boundaries in that case? We didn't do it. No time to do it. And then Luis Caffarelli, as always, he is, has priorities. One of the priorities is follow the Georgi. So there was this idea of proving that the solution in L1, after a second is bounded, after a second is C alpha, after a second is no more. So we proved this, the Georgi regularity. It took 2 years to do it. And then another thing that was very easy was entropy dissipation. I was freshly come from the French school doing dissipations all the time. You know, if you are in France or Spain, you are very dissipated yourself. So we dissipate everything. And this was a beautiful thing that was done very easily. So there is a second model. The second relevant model, if you want to do this evolution, fractional, nonlinear, is just putting the Laplacian S here, outside. So there is no divergence. But probability people say, whatever the people in mechanics say, the equations without divergence are good for probability. Probability goes to the viscosity concept, not to the integration by parts. So why not write this? And this motivation for that came from Stefano Olla, another Italian. And we had a whole project with my people in Madrid, De Pablo, Quiroz, Ana, and we published a number of papers proving that in the classical that we call Benny-Lambrechts-Crandall style, a semigroup of weak solutions can be constructed. It is a contraction semigroup, and it has smoothing, regularity, everything. So it's curious that this, which is less functional analytic in some sense, is a better semigroup. Okay. And in this case, since the divergence is not there to help you, the nonlinear effect is free, and it gives you infinite speed of propagation. So there is a model with the same exponents. You put an order in the exponents and you get finite. You put another order and you get infinite propagation. So let me now tell you what we did in the second model recently. There is another page. We tried to work on bounded domains. And I will not report on this work because it's complicated. And it's a project, also sub-project. But the complication of the theory when you are not working the whole space is that the boundaries are, you never have a nice life with boundaries because the equation remembers that you're trying to interact with outside. And this gives you enormous complications with the integrals that go to infinity. And I will not speak about that, but there are lots of works on that. And most of them were done with Bonforte, Segatti, Sires, Stan, Volzone. Let me tell you what we did with Alessio. Relatively simple. I will not explain the details. So we wrote two papers that have been published last year and were done essentially in Austin in 2016. and it was a basic regularity question. Solutions of these nonlinear degenerate parabolic equations, when they approach the boundary, are they nice or not nice? In parabolic equations, you call nice Hopf principle. The derivative is linear non-zero, and you call not nice the rest. So the problem is, are they nice or not nice? And we were working on that, and it was discovered that the standard Hopf principle, which means linear behavior near the boundary, is false for the fractional Laplacian that is defined by the Stein method. And this was a beautiful work by Rosoton and Serra, students of Cabré in Barcelona. They did it for their thesis. Incredible work. So the regularity is yes. You discover that these bad operators, the fractional operators, has a tendency to pile up at the boundary because of the way you kill the particles when they go out. And we try to understand for a number of these operators if you will have Hopf principle, yes or no. And then we compare the evolution case with the parabolic case. These two equations are similar. It's just replacing UT by U and then changing the letters to make it simpler to read. And then we had a difficulty in understanding something that it was strange. We wanted to prove that the regularity of the elliptic operators is also the regularity of the parabolic operators. And we were unable to prove a result that was missing. And we talked to Alessio. And then there was this Alessio in full force. Magical computations in two afternoons, we found that there was a gap. Once the gap was found, there is this theorem that you have to write in several months, that the evolution equations in some range of exponents get a new behavior. They don't try to work like the elliptic. Like the evolution is taking time to build up and get in the boundary conditions. At the end, it will get elliptic because there is asymptotic convergence. But before the end, for certain initial data, you lose it. And this is something that you need a person who sees how to compute. So thank you, Alessio. Let me tell you about the story. I don't have much time. The work with Caffarelli, I will explain the model a bit. It is UT, let me explain it because mechanics is important. Since the model was mathematically bad, it's important that the mechanics is clear. First, you write the continuity equation. So there is V. And then you say that V is the gradient of a potential. And you call the potential pressure. And the only thing you need now is telling that the pressure is related to U. In porous medium, it's a power of U. And we don't want to do that because we want to be non-local. So my proposal was, Louis' proposal was, put that P is a risk potential of U. And the risk potential has this kernel. It's just the Laplacian minus S, where before I put plus S, now I put minus S. It's a very good operator, wonderful properties in software of spaces, so there's nothing to discuss. So you write this thing, and you discovered you are solving a kind of system. You could probably relax the P to solve it by putting like P plus PT. This some people do, relaxing the second equation just to make it more reasonable. You don't get much more. But in any case, you put initial data and you solve it. And if you want to learn about non-local elliptic equations, which is first before you do this, there is this beautiful survey paper by Xavier Rosoton. He wrote the paper when he was in Austin. Austin was the origin of many of these ideas. And now we wrote a paper with my new group in Complutense, Diaz, Gomez, and... on the fractional Schrödinger equation. So if you want to learn elliptic equations, there's lots of things I am not covering because I am parabolic. And the application of these parabolic people is that you have to go to some people who really tell you that this is the model, don't change it. And these people were Jacomin and Leibovitz, and the paper looks very familiar to people who are doing material science or these Wasserstein methods. This is an awful way of writing things, but it seems to be clear to them. Okay. And then you can use different operators corresponding to different free energies. And there is another modeling that was very important for us, came from people in Wrocław, in Poland, Biller and Kars, working with Monod on this location. So there is a number of things, number of papers we did. They took a long time. We first proved existence of weak energy solutions, and we could not prove uniqueness. And then we did the renormalized Fokker-Planck equation, and we proved a stabilization. This is beautiful. And then we did what I call the Georgi program. L1 implies L2, L2 implies L infinity implies C alpha. And it took several years. It involves this guy in autonomous, So, and then we did the limit that was very important for people like Ambrosio and Serfati. If you go S tends to 1, you get a hydrodynamic limit of nonlinear diffusion that is just, let me tell you, if you put here in this equation, P equals Newtonian potential of U. And Serfati, I were in Barcelona, invited by Carrillo to one of these big meetings they organized, and not having anything to do one of these afternoons, we began thinking about proving this thing because I had recently read a paper by Ambrosio and Serfati. And we did it. It works. So you go from parabolic to non-parabolic. The hydrodynamic limit is not parabolic. Okay, so let me just, this is the, I try to document what I do. So in the old times, I wrote a book on porous medium where you can learn more or less many of the things we did before. And then a book on is fast diffusion. So this is 2007, and this is finished. And then in 10 years, I wrote this thing for Cetraro because they treated me so well, so we wrote it like crazy. In fact, all of us wrote wonderful things, I think. I like this thing. Okay. And now, instead of explaining what we do at this moment very much, let me tell you that I'm working with Antonio Segati in Pavia by doing something very strange. My potential pressure is not an inverse Laplacian. Now we put a positive Laplacian. So the equation, instead of going back in order, is more than 2. Goes between 2 and 4. And in that case, equations that go between 2 and 4 are relatively parabolic still. And this is something we are doing with Antonio Segati, writing nonlinear fractional equations of order between 2 and 4. In the limit 4, you get thin films. And we're trying to get thin films. And it is, we're in the middle of a nightmare. So let me tell you, let me jump on the regularity thing, and let me tell you what is the asymptotics, because it's incredibly simple. Asymptotics means that your equation will try to be self-similar if you change the variables according to the Lie group scaling, which is the scaling group. So you write some exponents that will be nice for what you do, and you change the equation. And my exponents, this is the compatibility with the equation, and then there is another compatibility, is conservation of mass. With these two compatibilities, I prove that this V, which is just changing variables, satisfies this monster equation, which is already autonomous. But now, I know that this equation has been renormalized. This is the nonlinear Fokker-Planck, for people who know that. And you say, this is impossible to solve. Let me tell you how to solve it, because it's a trick. I am trying to understand that this goes to equilibrium. So I eliminate Vt, and I get this equation. Remember that P, K of V is the pressure. And beta Y is the gradient of beta Y squared over 2. So put these things together, and you get this thing. Put capital letters now for the stationary state. Okay, so this is the stationary state. And then you say, listen, the stationary state has to have lots of symmetries. One of the things is that if there is a divergence equals to 0, it will be 0. So you write this equation. And if you are relatively good at complementary principles in free boundary problems. This is what says that if u is zero, it is zero. And if u is not zero, this gradient is zero. So this is the options, the two options. And of course, u is larger than zero. Once you discover that from this equation, which looks terrible, the stationary states will like to be as simple as possible, then you wrote your complementary principle. It says P, which is the pressure, is more than an obstacle, which is Cy squared. Second, U is the Laplacian S of P. We already knew that. Third, either P is the obstacle or U equals zero. This is the complementary principle. And this is, according to experts, an obstacle problem. And we were in Texas, and next door, Sandro Salsa was working with Caffarelli, and they had finished the paper where they proved that this obstacle problem has a solution that is C1s. If the obstacle is good, the solution is C1s, and the U is C1 minus S. And then you say, how does it look? It looks like this. This is your soliton. So if there is a soliton, it will be easy. And the only thing is prove that the soliton is found. How do you find the soliton? Of course, you write the free energy, you make the derivative, you calculate the dissipation, and it works. There's only thing I can tell you. When we discovered this thing, working out the free energy dissipation took one night, sleepless night. I was too nervous. Okay, so this is first part. This is the first part of the energy. This is the second part of the energy. You have to know what is your energy, which is V times P, which is like a moment, the free energy. And this is the second moment. And if you differentiate this free energy, it's minus I. I is this dissipation. Look at this dissipation. Either when the dissipation goes to zero, because you get this, the derivative of something that decreases has to go to zero. But when it is zero, either V is zero or this gradient is zero. You recognize the complementary principle? And you have to prove that it converges. It converges. So that's it. In collaboration with Segati, we are trying to do the same free energy calculations for the soliton. We already know the soliton. But the energy calculations have a tendency not to be good to conclude because there is something with the symmetries that we're missing. So we have to work a bit more. And this is the time. Let me tell you, thank you for your attention. Happy future, Alessio, and friends and family, and Scuola Normale, and rest of the happy family. And tante grazie, muchas gracias.
So thank you very much for this beautiful survey. Are there questions, comments? Okay, so if not, we can go to the coffee break and thank Juan Luis again. So let's continue this afternoon session with Antonio Corbo Esposito from Cassino, which is also an old friend from the times of Scuola Normale. We entered together the Scuola Normale in 1981, right? And we will be talking about an homogenization result with a gamma limit absolutely continuous with respect to a singular measure.
So first of all, before to come to the scientific part, and before to say a lot of good words about Alessio, I'm not afraid to repeat what other people told. And I want to tell some two, three little stories, and but very simple, but they will shed some light. So one story is just to start from the very end. So 1 week before the award of the Fields Medal, Alessio called me and told me, under the promise not to tell everybody. And substantially, I kept the promise. I told all, as Italian, I told only two persons. So I told to my wife and to my professor Carbone, under the promise not to tell to everybody. Then, fortunately, then the two funny things happened. So Professor Carbone kept the promise more than me. So actually, he told only to one person. But also, he wrote some riddle message to Professor Trombetti, another professor in Naples. And Professor Trombetti didn't understand anything, because the riddle was too enigmatic. So the secret was kept. But the very same day that Alessio was awarded, I was to the airport to carry back my wife that was coming from St. Petersburg. She is visually impaired, and so she spent some part of the year in St. Petersburg because therapies there are more possible. And so when we were driving back home, we began to started to talk about Alessio. And actually, since she's visually impaired, she passed a lot of time to listen to some radio stations. And her favorite radio station is it's Radio Cultura in St. Petersburg. And actually, she told that, you know, you told me, but I knew. Because in Radio Cultura, a couple of weeks before, there were rumors about the winning medalist of Fields medalist, and she I tried to check because and if also other rumors were actually true, but she remembered. No, I just noticed this name Alessio, and I remembered because she knows him, and maybe he is, and actually it was true. So maybe this is another proof of the so Russian information service is very good. and so this is one story. And second little story is I want to only partially confirm what Camillo told yesterday. Because at the very beginning, I remember what impressed me that Alessio, as soon as he was exposed to mathematics, was complete, like fire. It's just the better way to tell it. And actually, he told that he was not too bad just at that time and was not so behind other people. This was the Saturday, because he was getting exercises. And Wednesday, I remember that my first meeting with Alessio, he made a lot of questions, because, of course, he was lacking some basic definitions. So he correctly asked me a lot of definitions at my lecture in this. I want to remember other people that were there in Gaeta that year, also Professor Dvornicic and Massimo Gobbino, that were there also. And so, about Alessio, I want to say this. First, I'm very proud of you, as all of us, I think. And second, I want to better define what is my view of his. He's a person, besides to be a brilliant person, he learns very quickly from mistakes, not only from his mistakes, but also from other people's mistakes. And this is very important. This is not so common. And third, that he smiles. This is a very good, beautiful thing. And he does not smile at you, he smiles with you. And this is my take, my view of all the thing. And so, no, I just finished my stories, and so maybe we can start. Of course, you will notice that the level will come a little bit lower, because instead of a survey that covers the important work of many important mathematicians, you will have just a survey that spans all part of the activity of a very modest mathematician. But in any case, this was a problem that has something to do also, little bit with Alessio, because I told something about this kind of problem that at that time I was having only vague idea, still is vague, very vague, but something more maybe there is. And also has something to do, because very first question Alessio asked me was about binomial coefficients, so this is binomial, and so has something to do. So this is joint work with Roberto Alicandro from my same university. And we want to, also another thing I want to say, it's beautiful for me to speak about some result about gamma convergence that was introduced by Professor De Giorgi and Spagnolo. And for me, it is a pleasure to see that, in my humble opinion, the spirit of De Giorgi still operates in many ways in Pisa. I left Pisa many years ago. I came only back to Pisa the first time when De Giorgi passed away, and other times more recently. But first of all, I was astonished that when Alessio was in Pisa, some advices were still working. So I told some advices about some professor, about some things, and were true after 20 years that I was not in Pisa. So. Second, that I had the possibility to meet young people, and in my opinion, I can see, especially from the work primarily of Luigi, spirit of the Giorgi operates. I miss to thank very warmly and very deeply organizer Luigi, Alessio, and all organizers for having me here today. This is my pleasure and one of things that I will remember all my life long. So now we can proceed. Okay, so we consider a sequence of integral functionals. We start with the very simple functionals of the calculus of variation. And we consider with respect to a sequence of measures, mu h. But measure mu h will be absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure, but will not be coercive. And so they will weakly start converge to a singular measure, mu. Then, of course, in order to obtain coercivity, we will have to rescale, to properly rescale the functionals. And in effect, if we rescale the function, we can get gamma convergence. And the gamma limit can still be identified as an integral functional, but with respect to another singular measure. And the measure nu that appears in the limit depends both on the measure mu and the integrand, actually in the exponent p of the integrand. So let's start from the beginning. We use this one-dimensional toy measure, binomial measure. So we fix a parameter alpha between 0 and 1. And the binomial measure is defined in this way. It's the only measure, probability measure, that satisfies the following relation. You take the unity interval, you split into two parts, two equal parts, and you split the mass unevenly. You take alpha to the right and 1 minus alpha to the left. So, of course, if alpha is equal to 1 half, you will obtain the Lebesgue measure. But if alpha is different from 1 half, you will obtain one completely singular measure. Okay, we will see better too after. So you will do this on every dyadic interval. This by will determine one unique measure, and then you will get your mu alpha. So, okay, I told already this. Then, how to approach this measure? The approaching measures will be just the same, but the process will be stopped to the level k. So I will split this mass unevenly with the same scheme, same procedure, but I will stop to the level k. So up to the dyadic intervals of level k, I will have some density that will follow some rule, and then density will be constant with respect to Lebesgue measure. And so mu k alpha is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. So in order to better understand how the density looks like, on the left you have the density. You can identify six levels because k is equal to 5. And so you will have six possibilities, and this depends, we'll see after, on the addressing, binary addressing of the intervals, sub-intervals. And on the right, you will get the cumulative measure of the interval 0x, so the antiderivative of what you have on the left. And so parameters are 0.7, and k is equal to 5. So before to get to result, to actual result, we will make a quick tour about this mu alpha properties. Actually, I have another little story to say. First this page and then the story. If we take one point in the unit interval and take its binary expansion, we can write down the binary digits. And then we can compute the limit of the average of these binary digits. And this limit can be alpha, can also not exist, we will see after. But we will set F alpha, we will call F alpha the set where this limit does exist and is equal to alpha. Then what turns out is that this measure is concentrated on this set, that it ignores everything else. Okay? And these sets are mutually disjoint for every alpha, it's clear. And therefore, these measures are mutually orthogonal. And the Lebesgue measures is very well known, is concentrated on F1 half, that is called the set of normal numbers. This is very known, for example, to probability, people from probability and to many more people. And what is just a little bit less known, but it's already very old result. First time, this was my first exercise about this. I proved, but then we asked to Zanier and found that this was already proved in 1952 by Eggleston. Actually, methods of proof go back to Bezicovich. But F alpha, they have Lebesgue measure 0, except in the case 1 half that has Lebesgue measure 1, but the Hausdorff dimension is an entropy function, is precisely this entropy function. Okay. And in order to have a picture of this entropy function, it's just this. So you have dimension 1 for normal numbers, and the dimension, Hausdorff dimension, that goes to 0 as alpha goes to 0 or goes to 1. Then, first thing that, so we proved, we could not claim the proof of that result, so first thing we tried to prove that the sets where the liminf and the limsup were different, which one was the dimension. And the first results, it came more than 10 years ago, was that this dimension is the minimum between the alpha and the beta. So the alpha is the dimension of F alpha and the beta, the dimension of F beta. Another thing, because this whole thing started by the fact that Carbone holds the archive of letters of Cesaro. So Cesaro is known mathematicians and Neapolitan mathematicians of more than one century ago, and he's very, very well known for his averaging methods. And so we began to ask ourselves if there was some more powerful averaging method in order that we could use in order to get more numbers in some converging average of digits in some sense. Then it came out that if one uses matrices, infinite matrices, lower triangular, it means that you take into account only digits before. It's like time, you have to take into account only the past at the level n. And with the condition that will respect Cesaro averages, so usual averages, the limit of the usual averages. So if x is in f alpha, the limit of this method applied to x has also to be alpha. Then if one goes to the definition of t g alpha beta as the analogous definition, so where the limit is equal to alpha of the averaging method and the lim sup is equal to beta, then the dimension of the will not change. Will not change. And another thing, a little bit more strange, came, okay, all this is, the unity interval can be seen also on the torus, it's just the same. But if one has any complex measure, any, on 0, 1, one can find a lower triangular matrix of that kind. That kind can be described explicitly. I just, I wrote the condition, but there can be written conditions on the coefficients in the matrix that are if and only if the matrix is in that class, that if one applies these averaging methods, actually the measure is concentrated on the union of TF alpha. TF alpha, I did write the definition, but I think it can be understood because it's TG alpha alpha. Okay. So, provided the right, of course, there is, you cannot fix one T that is good for every mu, for every nu. This is not possible because it's very simple. But you fix nu, then you can find one averaging method that if you apply that averaging method, the measure nu ignores the sets where once you apply this averaging method, the lim inf and lim sup are different. This is, I don't know how to apply this, but it seemed to me. Okay, then you have some more properties. Actually, to have some integrational, numerical integration about the measure is very, very simple. There are some recursive formulas, and you can, starting from this, you can derive Newton Cotes formula with some weights, Gaussian quadrature formulas with some other weights, and this can be done. So this function is called the Refinel functional. This measure is also called the multifractal because it follows the scheme like a fractal. But actually, if you want to find the support of the measure, is all the unit interval. You cannot identify, like in the usual fractals, some compact support different from the. So now we can go to the actual problem. So, and my first question was, okay, I want to raise from 0 to 1 with respect to the measure mu k alpha, so the approximating measure. And we want to minimize with respect to H1 functions, where 0 in 0 and 1 in 1. So I want to just to jump, raise one unit. And the first lemma is very simple. You will find that the minimizing energy of this functional is rho to the power k, where rho is this constant. Of course, if alpha is equal to 1/2, this is 1, and the solution is always the unit, the linear function going from 0 to 1. If alpha is different from 1/2, the solution is not. It's piecewise linear because mu k at piecewise constant density. But actually, the solution is mu k 1 minus alpha 0x. So the reason is quite simple, because when you have low measure, you can have a higher derivative. And this can be done by very simple lemma, can be done by induction. And the key observation is this. If anything will be good from starting from this point, will be from this key observation. These solutions converge. They are convergence is monotonous and so uniform. So this suggests the idea that the limit in some way can actually be the minimizing the minimum of some variational problem. On the other hand, the problem is that the energy goes to zero. So there are many sequences of functions where the energy goes to zero and they will not converge to this. And so, okay. So on the left now you have the density. On the right you have the solution of at the level k. That is just the previous graph rotated pi degrees with respect to the center 1/2, 1/2. Okay. So our first theorem was just, so our scheme was like this. We know that this converges to a certain solution u. We want to know if this converges is by accident or if there is some down some gamma convergence of the functionals. Which functionals? In order to have coercivity of the functionals, we divide it by the energy at the level k. So we normalize the functionals. So now the minimum of this function will be 1, and the minimum function will be the previous one. But then we can use these functionals and to see that they gamma convergence, actually. So this is not very useful because we, at this in this toy model, because we already know the limit of the sequence of solutions. But it's just how to say, it's beautiful to see that if that there is underlying gamma convergence. So we could use either L1 or L infinite topology, and this Fk will gamma converge to this gamma limit Fu. And Fu now should be what you expect, because it is exactly the integral of the squared power of d du, taken only taken to the density with respect to mu 1/2 squared, integrated again in the mu 1/2, for only for BV functions that are absolutely continuous to with respect to mu 1 minus alpha. Okay, maybe I didn't read exactly, but you understood it's written well. So this was first result. So the limit will only take into account functions, will only see functions in a way. The limit preserves the shape of the limit functions. Okay. So after the case p equal to 2, we wanted to take one more general p. And so we try to have a different p we of course want to minimize along all functions of W1P, 0 and 0 and 1 in 1. And we obtain some analogous result. But the problem is now that we got one constant different depending on P raised to the K that has this form. Okay? And so actually you can write in several different forms, but if you will put P equal to 2, this will disappear, will be 1. This will be just the same as before, 4 alpha 1 minus alpha. Actually, okay. And if alpha is different from 1 half, we always have this constant less than 1. Okay. I here wrote less than 1 half, but it's different from 1 half. And so you can also make some exercise identifying, of course, C one half, P is one half, because you will fall back to the usual case of Lebesgue measure. And actually, I forgot to add one more graphic, because this rho P, when if we go back, okay, for alpha, one minus alpha is just a parabola turned upside down. And if we have P going to one, this parabola is not more a parabola, it becomes a straight line, two straight lines, it becomes two straight lines going from 0 to 1 to 1 half and from 1 to 0 back. If P goes to plus infinity instead, then it goes to 2 square root of alpha 1 minus alpha. I forgot to add this slide. So it's a little bit bigger, but it's not going to this is just okay. And then you can write down the theorem, and the theorem it looks perfectly analogous. You have if you properly renormalize functionals, then you can prove gamma convergence, and you can identify gamma limits. And the gamma limits is just the integral of d du in d mu c, where the c is this cp that we had here, this c here. And this c is only functions that are absolutely continuous with respect to mu c, and will not see any other function. Before to go ahead, I can also say, going a little bit back, that mu alpha is also connected with Pisa, because there was, I remember when I was studying for applying for researcher for the first position, entering position at that time, I remember to I had to train myself. And there was one exercise by Giorgio Letta he gave to some application in Pisa for researcher that asked for example of one increasing function, strictly increasing, with derivative almost every equal to zero. The example is just mu alpha. It's just example. It's a little bit better than the Cantor staircase, because it's strictly increasing and, of course, continuous. Then, okay, we then try to, I can tell you, proofs are elementary, but are not trivial. So there are things that have to be done. Then we try to cope with the case of controlled growth, peak growth, from above and below. And then another phenomenon appeared. So, of course, by this condition, you will have that the functional's minimum of energy should be rescaled in the same way. But in order to get the result, we had to assume one more hypothesis. We had to assume the existence of this limit. Oh, so this limit, we put this infinite in analogy with the linear case. It's very well in the community. I don't know if to call the P-recession function or something like this, but it's up to you, because I don't know if there is a standard notation for this. So, and we have to take into account if this limit exists. Then you have that if this limit exists, then you can again identify the gamma limit. And the gamma limit will be given by the integral of f infinity computed on the density of the u with respect to mu c, as before, in the mu c. And the constant are the same, is the same as before. But when we tried then for a couple of weeks to this, it's not possible that, first of all, why appears f infinity? F infinity appears because the in almost every point in the density, the derivative is very high. So it takes into account the function is just the behavior of f at infinity, approaching infinity. So then we tried to, we thought that if the limit didn't exist, the gamma limit exists just the same. Then we tried, then we found the counterexample. So the counterexample is this one. This function is convex, is between lambda 1 z squared and lambda 1 minus 1 z squared and lambda 1 plus 1 z squared. And if lambda 1 is large enough, the function is convex. And actually, the sequence of the values of minima of fk does not converge. Because this is convex, but it's oscillating between these two functions in very slow way in order to maintain convexity. And when this, we have these minimizing functions, the gradient will be just in an area where functional derivative will be in an area where f infinity is lambda 1 near to lambda 1 minus 1, and then for other k will be in an area where fk is near to lambda 1 plus 1, and so on. So there is no convergence. And of course, the assumption was not satisfied. So this example, in some way, shows that that hypothesis is not sharp, but so. And this is one attempt to make a graph in a good way, because it's very hard, since you can see how big are these numbers. Here, lambda 1 is 10. And then you have this sinus of this logarithm. So you have the function f is the red function in between. And this is between 11x squared and 9x squared. So sometimes goes nearby 9 squared, then goes nearby 11x squared. And here, just computed with the computer, the graph of f. A second derivative, just to convince you that actually is convex. And you can see that actually it's convex. So now this is a beautiful toy model, but what for? My hope, the motivation that brought me to study this maybe very unimportant problem, but The motivation was that there is still a big area where analytical methods are not very much useful. All this area where mechanical statistics has you have to first to grasp the first thing information to grasp is the rate of convergence of some the energy that dominates the all the stuff. Then you can do for example, my humble opinion, larger deviations began to match the bridge between these two areas, but it's still a lot has to be done. And so this problem is this is just one dimensional. So what to do? If you go to higher dimension, all problems appear. It's very difficult to extend these problems to higher dimension. In just one very simple case, we were able to do this. And this very simple case was that we tried to minimize, we took the tensor measure, just product measure, mu k alpha tensor mu k alpha. It's not just by chance that you have alpha and alpha. If you have alpha and beta, it's a different story. It's already a different story. But if you have alpha and alpha, first of all, which is the analogous problem? The analogous problem actually is the homogenization cell problem, not the Dirichlet problem. Because if you have this problem, this homogenization cell problem with the where u minus phi, where phi is, you can put any linear function. We just took x plus x plus wave just because of simplicity. Then you will have that the solution at level k will be a sum of function of x plus a function of k because of the structure, very simple structure of the meshes, and then. Solution will be this one. And then you can, by slicing methods, you can identify gamma limits, will be something already just a little bit complicated just to write. But the problem is then, if alpha is different from beta, then you have two constant, two rates of convergence to zero that are different. So one will dominate, and this will be the slowest one, gives higher energy, so you have to normalize with respect to this one. But then the other derivative gives energy that goes to zero, so you can play with this and to obtain several solutions and lack of compactness. You can try to several methods to try to cope with this, but this we still didn't find satisfactory method to cope with this problem. Then another thing, what about if one has a truly bidimensional fractal and Dirichlet conditions on the boundary? Just some remarks. One simple example, the integrand is just integral of the u squared. So you want to minimize the integrand and you put the Dirichlet conditions on all the boundary. So this time you take fixed. Here is always one, here goes zero and goes linearly way, and here goes linearly x. And then what you can do, like a fractal, you will use some kind of a Sierpinski triangle, Sierpinski gasket. So you will remove the central part and you will split evenly the measure on the three triangles. And you can do this several times. Even if you take the Dirichlet conditions, it seems you cannot move because you have these boundary conditions. But when you apply the second time the process, then you begin to have some freedom here. And actually, you can put zero measure zero on the black part, because in the one dimension you cannot, could not do, because this disconnected the set, and then if you put zero on some little sub-interval, you can go from zero to one on that sub-interval, and all compactness is lost forever. But in this case, what happened, just the starting point, is that the minimum, if you, okay, now you have measure one split among these nine triangles. This is 1, 9, 1, 9, 1, 9, and so on measure. And it happened that the good values here, I made just a computation, they have to be the average, because the problem is linear, the average of the points that are connected with straight lines to the point. For example, this value has to be the average of this and of this, so it remains 1/4. Here, instead, has to be the average between 1/2, 1, and 1, because here there are 3 points connected with straight lines, and so on. And so maybe this can be some starting point, but here there is interplay between the variables and everything is much more difficult. So paper is unfinished. I hope that we could cope better in the future with this. So then, what to say? First, congratulations from the heart. And this "May the Force be with you" is just not a silly reference to Star Wars saga, but actually is just an invite to all of you to take good care of your mitochondria. Because, and in the Star Wars saga, they are present and are called midichlorians, if you remember. Who is a fan of Star Wars saga remembers this. And these mitochondria are the very tiny, there is speculation that were formed of bacteria that we got inside our cells and that provide us with energy. So, also because life always takes a toll, stress is very potent, dark side of the force. So I spoke about dark side of BV, because this gamma limit is only Cantorian. It's not the regular part, it's not jump part, it's only Cantorian part. So I ventured in this dark side of BV, but I don't want to have any more to have to cope with the dark side of the force. I had to cope in the past. So maybe first with you, all the best for your future. And another thing, I actually forgot to tell the third story. The third story is that Alessio was always passing the bar. The bar raised, and he always passed. And I still have to see when the level, because actually, as Villani told, you met all expectations. And the problem is that the people keep having rising expectations. So. And but I still have to see the limit of this. And I think I didn't use all my time, but I think you all are quite tired, because Monday was a very emotional day also for me. Yeah, very emotional. And so thank you for your attention. And
so thank you very much, Antonio. Many questions, comments? Aspetta che arrivi il microfono.
So a way to see this result, right? That you have this fractal measure mu alpha, right?
Yes.
And then you end up with a sort of associated fractal measure in the gamma.
Yes. So some duality, some exactly. There is some connection. Not say duality, but there is some connection between, these are associated in some way, but...
So the obvious question that I have, right? So you start with one of these, I say, like Hutchinson, self-similar constructions.
Yes, this is the ultimate goal, and to have some same scheme that you can identify that energy goes to zero, but if you properly rescale, you get gamma convergence. And the ultimate goal is to... the problem is just not to to say that the gamma limit exists, just also to identify to see which one is the associated measure, because this is the problem. But so, okay, this took a couple of years. Not okay, for our modest, if one much better than us wants to join, so, welcome. But this was recovered because this was a kind of idea fix, the recurring idea in my mind. And then at the end, I just convinced Roberto to work with me, because motivation alone is not too much. And so the program ultimate goal is this one.
In the 1D case, you said,
yes.
Is it? Can you do also p equal 1? Because there you lose some uniqueness, right, also?
P equal to 1. Just let me think about it. If... if... it seems to me that then if P is equal to 1, actually the limit of the rho k to the P exists. So it should be just very simple to see the... but the problem is just that it seems to me that it is convenient to have you have not uniqueness, bro, not uniqueness in some kind of, because if you choose the biggest solution will be worse, because you then will go to raise only on the interval where the measure is lower, the density is lower. Mm-hmm. And so will not. In the end, you will get the limit. You will get a delta, so jump at zero, or jump at one, in the limit. But if you choose the smallest, just the same. No. But if you choose the smallest, you can.
The problem is that C doesn't converge. Right?
Yes. Yes, I will think about it, and as usual, I need some time to devise it. Yeah.
Any more questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank Antonio again, and for today, we're finished.